I just want to let you guys know that we have about 10 minutes before we start. So if you haven't found a seat yet, please find a seat, and there's plenty up and towards the front of the auditorium. Good morning again. I'm going to go ahead and just go through some of our pre-presentation information. So good morning, welcome to the 2020 Winter Workshop. And just wanna let you know that we have, other than our two introductory hellos, we have 18 presenters. And I just want to remind the presenters, look at your time frames, and then once the once your time is coming up, just come up to the front here about a minute or two before your presentation, just so we can have some good transition times. Like always, if you need your PDHs, please sign in. You have to sign in the AM and the PM. And as always, this is a school campus, so you cannot smoke on school grounds. You need to go out of the facility and down the road towards the gas station or the other way. If you have a cell phone, please put it on vibrate or silent. And if you need to talk to someone or you know need to do some business, please go out into the hallway away from the presenters. The bathrooms are down the hall to my right, to your left. And the emergency exits, as you can, they're all well lit, but there's one on the left and then the main hallway that most of you came in up on as well. Last year, there was a lot of people left trash at their seats. We just ask that you please be mindful. We are not your mothers, we're not your fathers, and there you go with the cell phone. as normal, we'll have two breaks, one in the AM, one in the PM, and then lunch, and we'll give you more instructions on lunch, but again, these two doors on either side of me, do not go around the curtains and go that way. We have a flow, it works, trust the process. Okay, I think I covered everything. One last thing is, we did move this to a one-day format, and I put Jim and I put a lot on our staff to pull this off for a one-day format, plus also with our reorganization that Shanté is gonna talk about a little later on. We did ask them to pull together, and I just like to recognize them. They did an outstanding job getting us to this point, and I'm sure through the finish line today as well. With that, I'd like to introduce Secretary Cohan.
So we're actually ahead of schedule, right? I'm sure it won't last, relax. So I'm here to welcome all of you to the Winter Workshop 2020. Doesn't 2020 still sound kind of crazy? Sounds like too futuristic, right? Well, I gotta tell you, the future of transportation is happening right now. So I wanna introduce you to George and Jane. These are our Delaware's first fully autonomous vehicles. Is that exciting? Oh, that was lame as hell. Was that exciting? Who would have thought that we'd be opening this 2020 winter workshop with two fully autonomous vehicles? That's pretty cool. So I woke up this morning and I was like, okay, I didn't really prep, so sorry. And I thought maybe I shouldn't have had that third glass of wine last night. And I'm thinking, but what a great time to be in public transportation. Right? It's a really exciting time. We have so many cool things going on across the department. We just rolled out our next generation kiosks at DMV. Has anybody seen those yet? You can do all of your driver's license information, all of your vehicle information. They are awesome. We are actually launching our first fleet. We have about 20 all-electric vehicles, which John Sisson is going to talk to you a little bit about this afternoon. We just launched our cooperative automated transportation section, CATS. And you're going to hear from our new chief innovation officer this afternoon. So we're very excited about that. We're almost completely completed with our moving our paratransit fleet to all propane. So that's better for the environment and reduces greenhouse gases. Because as you know, all of you, that the transportation sector is the number one contributor to greenhouse gases currently. We're doing a lot of cool things on the accelerated construction side. We have a $4.5 billion CTP over the next 6 years. Woo! Now everybody's awake, Shanté. I appreciate you. You have been completely assimilated. I love it. So that is very exciting. We just opened with 301, our all-electronic tolling. We're going to be moving to all-electronic tolling for Route 1 very soon. That's exciting. So really, I mean, there's just so much cool things going on. At the TMC, we just received a grant for some artificial intelligence. So we're going to be able to predict traffic crashes before and as they happen and automatically change our system and change our lighting. So I think that is very cool. So it's 2020. We have fully autonomous vehicles. We're dabbling in artificial intelligence. God only knows what's next, people. So this should be a day full of information. You've got a lot of great speakers. I'm very excited to spend the day with you guys and looking forward to it. And a huge, huge, huge shout out to our partners from Federal Highways who are here on their day off. So Doug Atkin, why don't you come on up, and I apologize in advance.
Highways to Delaware. I came last April as the division administrator, came from Nebraska. Where's Bob out there? Bob sent out all the emails and stuff. Well, Bob's a Nebraska fan, and so we checked in on that. But a little bit about me. I've had a chance to meet with some of you, but and tell you a little bit about my background. But I want to go ahead and let you know that, or tell all of you that, and then kind of talk about my philosophy as a division administrator and how I want to work with DelDOT. I graduated from Utah State University with a Bachelor of Science degree in Civil Engineering in 1985. Then I went to work for the Utah Department of Transportation, spent 12 years with Utah DOT in bridge design, working with local public agencies. Special Projects Engineer, which basically oversaw rest areas and ports of entry. And then I was called down to the front office and asked to lead the project management of the I-15 General Development Plan, and basically what that was they wanted to reconstruct I-15 through the Salt Lake Valley. It's about 16 miles of urban freeway. And so I got involved as a project manager in the early development of that project. We were trying to figure out how we wanted that project to be configured and what we wanted it to look like. That eventually became the I-15 design build project. It was built in the late 90s, early 2000s, prior to the Winter Olympics in Salt Lake. From there, I went out and I worked a couple of years in construction, working with contractors and things, so I got a good taste of that part of life as well. During that time, I had the opportunity to go work for URS Griner on the I-15 design build project, so I was on the design side of that project. I was with URS Griner, then URS for 5 years. Then I was with a small regional firm in Utah for 5 years. I joined Federal Highway Administration in 2007 in the Utah Division. 2010, I went to Nebraska as the Assistant Division Administrator. And then this last April, I came here to Delaware. And we're getting our feet wet, if you will, here in Delaware. We're getting around the peninsula. We're seeing a lot of neat, fun things and exploring our new home. So we're really excited to be here. Kind of my philosophy, Federal Highway Administration is responsible for stewardship and oversight of the Federal Aid Highway Program. Stewardship is that effective, efficient use of public funds to optimize our highway system through the Federal Aid Program. But really, we're all responsible for that stewardship, whether we're working for DelDOT, whether we're working for the Federal Highway Administration, or whether we're consultants and contractors supporting DelDOT in the construction of those highways. It's really about that public service that really got a lot of us into to what we do. It's the kind of the thing that motivates us. It's one of those things that we're part of something bigger than we are individually, and we do have that opportunity to provide service to the public. And I don't know about you, but to me, there's a lot of satisfaction in that sense of public service. Oversight has to do with those compliance with the laws and regulations that govern, in our case, the Federal Aid Highway Program. But I know just from my experience at the Utah DOT that Delaware has a lot of laws and regulations that govern what you do in your work that come from the state side. DelDOT's role in that stewardship and oversight, really in the whole program, this is a state-administered, federally assisted program. So see, Secretary Cohan, I got that. I'm from the government. We're here to help. State-administered, federally assisted. But that state-administered really says where the work happens. It's really the responsibility of each and every one of you here at DelDOT to make that work happen. Philosophically, good stewardship, this efficient, effective use of the public funds, good stewardship leads to compliance. If we're good stewards, compliance kind of takes care of itself. I see the stewardship as that opportunity to, you're doing good stewardship is the opportunity that we take to strengthen programs and strengthen people. It's the things we do to work together to make our work better and to do better at the work that we're doing. This year, this past year, and this coming year, Federal Highway Administration is involved with DelDOT in a lot of initiatives that you guys are doing. One of those initiatives is that I-95 rehabilitation project that's coming up. Federal Highways has been working with DelDOT. We brought in the Resource Center to help organize and help do some things to make that project go better. We stand here to assist you in every way that we can. Safety, this year, Delaware is updating the Strategic Highway Safety Plan, and we'll be working with you through that effort. We've got a utility program assessment going on right now with Eric Simo and his group, looking for ways. I know that a lot of you have been involved in that. You've come over to the office. You've done some interviews with Carolyn and Eric. But looking for ways that DelDOT can work better with the utility companies, coordinate better, and find some efficiencies there. Becky Liedebohm in our office will be working with John Caruana in updating the CE form for NEPA. Secretary Cohan mentioned the Advanced Transportation Congestion Management Technologies deployment, which is a fancy way, a big... Delaware got a grant because Delaware is taking some leadership in developing artificial intelligence on traffic management, on traffic systems maintenance and operations. And DelDOT is also taking the lead with the I-95 coalition on mileage-based user fee. Again, they were able to obtain a grant through Federal Highway Administration to help fund that effort. This partnership with DelDOT has started way before me, and it'll continue after me. But I look forward to this year working with you and really to several more years ahead being here in Delaware and working with you in this partnership. With that, thank you very much for this opportunity to spend my holiday with you.
Shanté Hastings, our chief engineer, and she's here to talk to us about transportation solutions update.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, that's pretty good. Great to be with all of you this morning. Little bit sleepy. We took our girls to Paris for about 5 days, and we got back last night. I always like visiting places and seeing kind of how they deliver transportation, so we did a ton of metro riding and walking. We Ubered just a couple of times, and so it's just interesting to see how different places move people. Obviously, Delaware is set up a little bit different than a big city, but I always just appreciate both what I learn and also when I come back and can get back into our transportation system. So we always start our presentations with our mission and vision statement. So excellence in transportation for every trip, every mode, every dollar, and every one. And this is really important to the department, and this is why we exist, to deliver excellence in transportation. When I was at TRB a few weeks ago, I heard somebody say something that really resonated with me, and so my next slide is going to talk a little bit about that. But I just want you to think a little bit about what transportation is to people. So everyone is really given talent kind of equitably. So everyone has different talents. It may not be the same talents, but everybody has talents. But the opportunity isn't necessarily equitable depending on where you live, where you're from. And so what transportation does is it allows people to get to those opportunities, whether it be jobs so that they can provide for their families, education so that they can get a good job at some point, healthcare to care for themselves and their family members, to be able to go and visit family, to have social activities with friends and family, and to meet their basic needs, whether it be to get gas in their car or put food on their table. That's what transportation means to people. That's what we're doing here. That's what we're all about. So it's not necessarily about the projects that we're doing or the permit that we're processing or the traffic counts that we're obtaining. It's about connecting people to opportunities so that they can transform their lives. So with that, actually, I want to go back real quick. So I want to talk a little bit before I get into the DOTS update to kind of recognize the work that we did over the past year. So we collectively in this room and people that aren't here delivered a $535 million capital program. So the biggest capital program that we've delivered, and this year is even bigger. And we can't do that with everybody, without everyone in this room, whether it be DelDOT staff, our partners, whether it be at Federal Highways, our consulting partners, higher education partners. We all work collectively to be able to deliver the transportation system that people need to get to opportunities. And so I want to take a brief moment, because we don't get to do this in a big crowd very often, to recognize those achievements. I won't list projects individually, but I want to kind of recognize different sections and groups of people. So our support sections really take on a huge workload because they're supporting the entire department in all of their efforts. And so they're not just working on one or two projects. They're working on everything across divisions to help deliver our program. So I'm going to announce some people, and I want you to just stand up. So our finance division, DTC, HR, stand up if you're here. I'll start calling you out. Maintenance and operations, planning, community relations, technology and innovation, DMV, specifically from DOTS, our right-of-way folks, our team support folks, utilities, traffic. Thank you, Monroe. You're the only one who stood up so far. traffic, environmental, ENS, M&R, construction, audit, civil rights, stormwater management, survey, engineering support. There are more people in this room that should be standing up. All of kind of any support role, if you're processing permits, if you're reviewing plans, thank you for your hard work in delivering our program. On the design side, North and South Project Development, Bridge, Pavement Management, Planning, Traffic, Facilities, our M&O districts, DTC, if you're involved in designing projects, stand up. Thank you. For the Federal Highway Administration, for the support that they give us technically as well as financially, to our higher ed partners who help us deliver sessions like this as well as give us students that help feed into our pipeline. And our consulting partners, thank you for your assistance in helping us to deliver. That's $535 million that has transformed people's commutes to work, to school, to get them where they need to go to improve their opportunities. So thank you, and I want us to make sure that we celebrate the work that we do because we work really hard. We don't get the opportunity to do that often. Most of the time, if I'm calling you, it's probably to ask you, why are we doing something? Or, you know, can you do it differently? So let's celebrate what we've done and what we continue to do because there's a lot of work left to be done as we continue to transform transportation in our great state. So with that, late summer, early fall, we did some restructuring within Transportation Solutions. Transportation Solutions is the major project delivery arm of the department. Obviously, there are other groups that put together designs for projects, but we oversee the construction of most projects that the department puts out, and we design a bulk of them as well. And so we wanted to look at our operation and see how we could kind of concentrate on project delivery a little bit better, improve communication, improve collaboration, and just try and streamline things. So with that, we restructured to create two deputy director positions, one overseeing all of the design groups, so that would be Bridges and Structures, PD North, PD South, Traffic Engineering, and then Pavement Management is a subset under that as well. as well as our Deputy Director of Operations and Support, overseeing construction and materials, environmental administrative support, right-of-way, and traffic ops and management. So we did this for a few different reasons. One, to give these groups that play kind of similar roles, one person to report to help kind of problem solve across the silos, if you will, and also for those two deputies to then be able to collaborate amongst their groups so that we can all be a kind of cohesive team. There's 425 DOTS employees, that's a lot of staff, and so we needed to organize to be able to streamline more effectively. So some of the changes included moving our rail program from the right-of-way group into traffic engineering. And that really just helped us to better align our resources for our highway rail grade crossing program, as well as utilizing the administrative and financial finance support staff. We moved the PAR program, as well as the Accessible Pedestrian Facilities Compliance Design Review Program, to planning so that we could have all of our PED statewide programs under one division. Our paving program, headed up by Sarah McDougall, now reports to our Deputy Director of Design, Mark Lutz. And that was really in recognition of the fact that our paving program is our largest statewide capital program. And so it needed to be, I would say, elevated a little bit more. And it's become more complex over the years. There's more full extensive reconstruction projects. There's a lot of curb ramp work, guardrail work, you name it. And so our hope is that by moving it into the design group, that there will be some collaboration between North PD and South PD, as well as pavement management, to continue to deliver that program. We also moved the CCR compliance program under engineering support, which was formerly OPM, just in recognition of kind of their role of reviewing plans and specs and making sure that what the contractor is doing conforms to our plans and specifications. And then I would say the biggest change that we made is to have materials and research and construction report to one chief, and that is Mark Buckalew. And so, in delivering our program, obviously construction is kind of the biggest chunk of that capital expenditure that we have every year. And so making sure that any, whether it be issues or collaboration that's needed, can have one person kind of over it when you're looking at the materials that are being placed as well as the inspection of those materials. So a couple of things that we've noticed when we put this out, we said, we're going to evaluate it and see how it goes, and if we need to make tweaks, we will. In my opinion, it's going pretty well. I think Jen makes fun of Jim, Mark, and I because we are working just so well together and collaborating really well together, and I think all the chiefs are working well together. And just a couple of kind of highlights. So one of the things was the project websites. You know, one of our biggest and maybe biggest challenges, I'll say, is communicating what we're doing to the public. They just want information. They want to know where we are with things. And, you know, we're so busy focused on getting plans done or buying right of way that, you know, that communication sometimes lagged. And so Mark was able to work with all of the design groups and kind of revamp the project websites. They're all very consistent. They're all updated on a monthly basis. And it's been really great to be able to point the legislators and their aides there and the community really and say, hey, all of the information is there. You can see the concept plans. If you have questions, please contact us. But all of that information is at their fingertips, which is the world that we live in now. So that's been a huge bonus. And he's even been able to work with pavement management. So we actually even have the paving lists up there and the status of them as well. And then on the other side, when talking about Jim, you know, a lot of our ENS issues that we had really last year, last summer anyway, having both ENS and construction under Jim has been a great benefit. He's been able to problem solve, and we've also been working on putting out a pilot to hopefully maybe change the way that we're doing things by allowing the contractor greater control, I would say, over ENS, both the design as well as making updates. And when they change their phasing, then they're responsible for making the update to the SWIP plan. So just two examples of some things that have come out of this restructuring so far. And we will continue to monitor and look for additional ways to improve. And so with that, I'll open it up for any questions that you may have about DOTS, and the restructuring. All right, thank you everyone. Have a great day.
Thank you, Shanté. Okay, the next one is lessons learned from past innovative projects. John Karam and Eric Yoder.
We don't have the slides. Good morning, everyone. My name is Jonathan Karam. I'm a project engineer in the bridge design section.
And I'm Eric Yoder.
And today we're going to be presenting on innovative lessons learned on innovative on past innovative projects featuring Bridge 3-507 in Millsboro, US 113 Iron Branch. So this is the location of the project. It's in Millsboro off US 113. Here's a site aerial. As you can see, the bridge location is highlighted, and you can see our DelDOT right away there, as well as the northbound and southbound lanes. Here's a timeline of the project. In 1915, there was concrete encased beams that were installed, followed by 1946, it was widened with a concrete frame. And then additionally, again, in 1965, it was widened again. And in 1997, we installed scour protection with R7 riprap. So this is the existing structure. As you can see, it's kind of a Frankenstein. It's hodgepodge together of, you know, three different structures. You know, there's a lot going on here, and I'll go through the existing structures and the condition of each one. So here's the condition of the 1915 concrete encased beams. As you can see, there's a lot of corrosion. They're not in great shape. Once this starts to happen, you don't really know what's going on underneath with the other beams. So with this, this was the need. As well as the 1946 portion, as you can see, there's a large crack and, you know, some delamination stuff happening here too. So this is right at the joint between the two, and this was another reason that it was structurally deficient. So as you can see, the concrete reinforced frame from 1965 was in much better condition, and we ended up deciding to keep that portion. We had some concerns with full replacement. So if we were to remove, you know, portions of the 1915 bridge, we'd want to remove it all at once because there could be a possibility of failure with the beams acting together. There was also drainage issues with two large pipes coming into the middle. There's a high ADT here, 40,000 cars, more in the summer. We picked the off season, so there'd be less cars. And there's also a lot of MOT and temporary paving issues if we were to go with a contra flow way instead. So as you can see, these were the design alternatives that we went through. Single lane closures, we talked about that. It wouldn't really work because of the you know, full replacement of the beams. You couldn't remove them individually, so you couldn't use the single lane closures. Contra flow, like we said, that wouldn't work because of the temporary paving, and you'll see in the next slide how long the taper lengths were for this. So we eliminated that, and then we went with the full closure option where we're going to detour southbound 113. So these were the contraflow traffic shift impacts. Even with a reduced speed of 45 miles an hour, we still had a taper length of 4,500 feet, and this was based on the skew of the road and the amount of offset we needed to do to fully remove the 1915 and 1946 portions. And like I said, this will be the project scope. We'll remove the 1915 and the 1946 portions. Those will be the limits of the removal and the replacement of the bridge, and we'll then match into the 1965 frame that will remain. So we have accelerated bridge construction versus traditional. Traditional would take over 6 months for something like this. There'd be a very high impact to all the traveling public. Northbound would be impacted. With the accelerated one, we're able to close off the workspace. We're able to get this done in, you know, we told the public 2 weeks, but we actually got it done in 9 days. And this allowed for a safer work area, and it was just Much easier for the whole public overall, and less impact to the businesses since they were still able to access them. So we went through a construction feasibility study. We had AECOM perform. So initially we thought we could get it done in 7 days. They came back and said 9 days is more realistic. So we went with the 9-day closure, and then we advertised it as 14 to the public. So we kind of, you know, under promise and over deliver. So our proposed plan was to go in and do paving of the detour ahead of time, just since we knew we were going to detour a lot of traffic onto that road. We wanted to make sure that was taken care of in advance. Then phase two would be stream diversion while the road's still open. Then we're still saving time. Phase three would then be replacement of the bridge and closure of the road. Finally, we would remove the stream diversion once the road is open and complete any additional grading. So we did a lot of public outreach with this project. We held multiple town hall meetings. You know, we met with the city council, police department, you know, legislators, and then we also held a public workshop, did various interviews with news channels, and we also handed out brochures. So we created these brochures. There's also an inside portion of them. This is just the front and the back. It had the condition of the bridge with a couple pictures and then a image of the local detour, so people kind of knew what they were, you know, anticipating. And we handed out probably over 1,000 of these brochures and left them at various businesses. That way people could come by and pick them up. And it was actually very well received. Everyone was, you know, happy that we were getting out there and letting them know, you know, let your customers know, everything like that beforehand. So it's probably close to 40 businesses as well as houses along US 113. So we had some pre-construction preparations. We added disincentives and incentives to the project. So if they got it done a day early, they'd get $12,000. If they got it done a day late, they'd be dinged $12,000. We also made sure to add language in the contract for weather so they could pick a week that was going to be, you know, good weather, not going to have rain, not going to hold us up. So once we told the public we're closing it, we're not going to have any issues being held up. So we also had a pre-bid meeting as well, and any contractor that wanted to bid on this had to come to the pre-bid meeting so they understood all the risks and, you know, incentives, disincentives, everything associated with it. We had our pre-construction meeting like normal, and then Eric and I provided on-site design support for the entire 9-day closure. So the contract was awarded to Mumford & Miller. The bid came in about $60,000 less than the engineer's estimate. They were the only bidder, so it shows a little bit of risk with this project. So, you know, not every contractor is going to be okay with something like this, but in this case, we did get a good one to bid on it, and we were satisfied with their bid. And like I said, $12,000 a day for the incentives and disincentives. So construction begins, and we have a very, you know, kind of a magnifying glass on us. You could see that these are different articles from newspapers. Even on the Google map, it had, you know, something about the closure. So people were very involved and you know, looking at this project as, you know, they're being uncertain if it would be able to be done in the 9 days, since it was such a fast, you know, a lot of work to do in such a little time. So Eric will take over from here.
Good morning. I started about not quite a year ago, so this project was part of my construction rotation training. This project was really cool since it was accelerated. Got to see a lot of things happening quickly, but at the same time, there was a bunch of stuff happening at night that I didn't get to see, so some pros and cons there. So I'm just going to walk through kind of what happened during construction day by day. So before we came out there, John mentioned during phase one, they closed, or they milled and overlaid the detour route to help with the increased traffic and trucks that were going to be taking that road. Phase two was the stream diversion. That also happened before we got there, but you can see they set up those sandbags and then the pump to reroute the water for the streams. They had a dry area to work in. Then day one, we showed up early in the afternoon. They had already closed up the road, started on demolition, and then actually dug down to the frame there. So, for the demolition of the structure, there's an attachment onto that excavator, like a jackhammer, so they could break up the concrete. And then another excavator would remove the beams once they had it broken up. Quite a bit of rebar in the deck there. It was pretty difficult to claw some of that out. Day two, they had finished removing the superstructure. By the time we had showed up, they were working on breaking up the abutments and removing those concrete chunks. And on the right there, you can see the existing frame that was going to remain and kind of a jagged edge. They weren't able to make a clean cut with just the equipment they had. So they brought in a subcontractor with a wire saw to clean that up and make a smooth connection. So the wire saw has diamonds impregnated in that rope, and they set up that frame like with a pulley system. And I've got a short video here kind of showing how that works. So it's wrapped around that stem there, and then the wheel in the middle is kind of pulling back on it, creating a tension on that stem, and it's pulling the wire through the concrete. Took a little while. And there you go. Day three, they had finished the bulk of the excavation. They had installed this trench box system to protect the excavation and keep it from the dirt from caving in. Groundwater was a pretty major issue throughout this project, but it was day three was especially noticeable. They were working to get down to grade at this point. There was a lot of digging and then placement of gravel to kind of try to mitigate that groundwater. Day four, more excavation, and a good bit of the crew was working on doweling into that existing frame, putting in rebar to create the closure pour connection joint. That was some pretty hard material. It ended up working most of the day we were there. Day five was the exciting day for me. That was when they were assembling the frame. They brought in an extra crane. Some of those pieces were about 25 tons, so they needed the extra lifting power. One of the good things about this project was we were right next to a shopping plaza, so there was a big parking lot that the contractor was able to use to stage all the semis that were there with the frame. Also good for me and John, there were a lot of restaurants around there that we could go to for lunch, so if we forgot to bring lunch one day, there's a Chick-fil-A right there. He kept getting free sandwiches, so we had to keep going there, right? They had placed the footers the previous night, so they were able to start with the frames first thing in the morning when we got there. And the way the frame system works, as they place new pieces, they would use a come-along. On the right picture there, you can kind of see there are these anchor points on the interior of the frame, so they could connect to two of them and pull them together. The frame was post-tensioned, so that created an extra strength for at the end of the project. They were kind of feeding that wire through the frame as they assembled it. Because of the transpox system they used, the cross braces sometimes got in the way when they were trying to put the frame in, so they had two cranes there, the regular one and then the extra one that they brought in, that they could kind of finagle the pieces around to get them into place. Day six, the frame was finished. They started framing up the closure pour to prepare to pour that. And on the left there, you can see the moment slab and the barrier wall. Day seven was excavation for the wing walls. And then they began to place those. Pictures there. While the contractor was working on placing the wing walls, the other half of the crew was working on backfilling the main structure and compacting the soil. Day eight, they had finished placing the wing walls and they backfilled them. They had finished working on the backfilling of the main structure, and we're working on the sub base for the pavement up top. Frame's looking pretty good on the inside. And they actually had some time to work on the drainage area on the right side of the frame. Day nine is opening day. They had paved through the night in stripes. There was some rain that was moving in, so they wanted to get working on that as soon as possible so they didn't have to wait till. If they hadn't striped through the night, they would have had to do that after the end of the 9 days, because they had to open in the middle of the afternoon and it rained pretty much all morning while we were there. They opened it that afternoon. They had about 10 or 15 minutes to spare before the cutoff time. They're pretty happy about that. And then just a week or two ago, John and I went out for final inspection. A couple minor things to take care of, but everything's looking pretty good. And back to John.
So with the project, I'd say it was a success. We had a lot of kudos from the public afterward. This was from the Millsboro Fire Company Facebook page. And you can read through a few of these. You know, people were, I'd say, impressed and surprised that we were able to get it done so quickly. So we said 14 days to them, and we got it done in 9. So, you know, 5 days early, that's pretty big. And I think people had doubts if we'd even get it done in the 2 weeks. But people, they saw us working out there 24/7, and I think that was, you know, good for them to see. So when they're driving by a site, they see guys working the whole time. It's not just, you know, a couple guys out there. They had, you know, 3 shifts constantly rotating, sometimes doubling up. It was a lot of work going on. So here's some lessons learned that we had from it. One thing would probably be to include an additional pre-con meeting to go over the contract documents with the contractor. And if they wanted to do any additional coring or any additional investigation, we would have that set aside. I think the public is more open to 24/7 operations and a full closure like this if they know that we're you know, hitting the ground running, and we've gone out there, we did our public outreach, so they know they're anticipating the project, they can plan around it, and you know, when we're able to hit the deadline or deliver early, I think that speaks volumes to both the department and DelDOT. So thank you, everyone. Just want to thank, you know, Group 3 Construction. They were out there inspecting, and George was doing a great job managing the project. We had, you know, our traffic section who allowed us to close 113. They did a lot of MOT and a lot of work for that. Millsboro Police Department were out there the entire time. You know, town of Millsboro and their city council and everything. Mumford did a great job with the project. KCI was out there inspecting, and then Guys and Bridge also helped out, and you know, attending the town hall meetings, public workshops, and just you know, helping out throughout the whole process of the project. And lastly, Jerry helped out with the brochures, which was a great help. So, if anyone has any questions. So since I was in okay. So she was just wondering kind of the benefits of being out there, providing on-site design support during the entire closure. With me being the project engineer, I was very familiar with everything going on. I led the project from the beginning to the end and went to all these meetings, and I was able to kind of make decisions on the fly if anything came up. You know, we could say that's okay, or let's change it up. So that really saved time instead of having to call someone or say, hey, can you come down here and look at this? And then for Eric, it was kind of, a good learning experience since this was just his first year getting into bridges and everything like that. So anything else? All right, thank you.
Thank you, John and Eric. Our next presenter is Mark Lutz, talking about plan lane restrictions and road closure policy.
All right. Thanks, Maureen. Good morning, everybody. Oh my God, I can't think of anything more boring to talk about than policy. Whew! So, as I put this together, I was putting myself to sleep. So, I actually, just to keep my own interest in this presentation, I threw some pictures of my kids in it just to wake myself up. But ironically, so we probably should have reversed this. This really relates a lot to what John and Eric just had a great case study of the implementation of this policy. So it probably would have been better if I had gone first to talk more general, and then they could have gone into a nice, an outstanding specific example. So a couple things. So we want to talk, or the department is a lot about delivering projects faster and meeting our commitments, but a couple things that this presentation is not about. I'm not talking about design build or CMGC. Also not talking about once we're in construction, if we need to do, we used to call them acceleration agreements. That's not really a good term. I don't know if there's a good term, but like call it a back on track agreement. So that's not what this is about. This is about something we've been doing this for years. It's not like what we've been doing is new, but about 5 years ago, we realized we needed a better documented policy and to give everybody guidance on how to do this type of work. So the main goals of this policy are to think through how we're going to be impacting the public, traffic, all road users, communicate that to the public, and then do everything we can to meet those commitments that we've made to the public. All right, so this will be a little bit of a theme of the presentation is that, yes, we understand that time equals money. So if we're gonna be getting things done faster, that means we're gonna be paying more for them. So that's, when I talk about this topic in general, often the complaint that comes back is that's gonna be expensive. And yes, there's an understanding that if we want things done fast, it's gonna cost some money. Here's another way to look at that. I love this. This diagram that You can't have good, fast, and cheap. That is impossible. You can't have all of those. So as a department, we have decided we want good products and we want it fast. So we know that it's the same thing, time equals money, it's not gonna be cheap. Now, there's reasonableness to all that. That's why it's kind of the whole Venn diagram going on here. There's not, you're not, you know, we're not putting in gold-plated guardrail. We're not getting things done in one day. There's reasonableness involved, and every project has to be thought through. But in general, we know that we're gonna be paying a little bit more to get things, a good quality product, and get it done as quickly as possible. So here, the first, the link there is just the link to all of DelDOT's policy implements. So it's kind of a little bit hidden in the intranet, so I just wanted to put that whole the whole link up there. So that's to all the DelDOT policy implements. The one we're talking about particularly today is C9, and again, about 5 or 6 years ago, we realized we had several projects where we had some less than good communication to the public. There were some last minute decisions. We had some major road closures that led to a lot of angst, and we realized we needed something in writing. So we had a policy that was developed by a group of folks from construction and traffic safety and design and others that was adopted in 2016. And what I'm kind of focusing on today is that we have some updates to that policy, which are on the cusp of being implemented. So hopefully it'll either be signed and put out onto the that website either this month or next month. And then the purpose, which did not change from the current policy implement to it, I'm just gonna read it off, to establish a uniform approach to minimizing the traffic impacts resulting from construction and maintenance work occurring on the state's roadways. Just wanna emphasize a little bit more that this is the department's policy. This is not traffic safety's policy. It's not my policy. There's some folks that get blamed for trying to enforce or use this policy. The folks that are working on that, they are doing their due diligence to try to follow this policy. So again, when understanding, when you're in construction, stuff is happening, right? We get that, everybody gets that. But when stuff is happening and we need to make a change from what we told the public, when we told the public we weren't gonna close lanes during the day, or that the detour was only gonna last 2 weeks, and something happens that it's gonna go beyond what we told people, that we recognize that, we wanna try to prevent it if possible, but if it happens, we need to communicate that. So Jennifer needs to know when we're gonna be shutting down I-95. So there needs to be communication and outreach to the public that, hey, this weekend, we didn't realize it, but because of some issues, we're gonna have more closures than we originally thought. So it's not that you can't do something, it's that we wanna minimize those changes, but also, again, communicate them. All right, so during design, so this is one I wanna make clear, is that during design, this is the design project manager's responsibility. So over the last year or so, I've seen a couple instances where it was a little unclear, like everybody else kind of thought somebody else was working on this, and that's not the case. The prime responsibility is the designer. So they're gonna have help, again, so obviously, just like anything else related to constructability during design, it's usually the designer, the construction section, and the traffic safety section, working through the MOT, how it's gonna be built, how long it's gonna take, et cetera. Again, we also have community relations involved, contract administration on the exact wording, on what's gonna go into the contract, and other support sections as needed. So now, once the project's in construction, of course, construction is the prime implementer and primarily responsible. And I don't remember if it was last year or the year before, but Rob gave a very clear direction to the world, right? When you're anything in construction, it's the construction engineers, the construction section's responsibility. They get input from others, but ultimately it's their responsibility. Same thing with this. And again, I already went through my spiel on, we get it, things happen, but there needs to be communication. So one of the main things with in our new policy that is we've made more clear is that when there's going to be a road closure, at a minimum, we need to have a disincentive included in the contract. So again, in the past, whether it was a bridge project or any other project we have, we didn't necessarily have any hammer on the contractors when we had a closure. So they could drag it out for a long period of time, and really the only thing we would have would be liquidated damages, which is a relatively small, it's not much of a hammer, let's put it that way. So at a minimum, we want to have a disincentive. Depending on the type of project, you may need an interim milestone as well. In other words, if the road closure is only a part of your project and it's not really at the end of the project, you may need the interim milestone included for that disincentive. Other options are incentives, or like Eric and John were talking about on the last project, where it had both a disincentive and an incentive. A plus B bidding, we've been, I think, very successful with A plus B bidding over the years, and I think we'll probably use that more and more moving ahead. Another option that I don't know that we've actually implemented, we tried and then we didn't, we ended up rebidding, was something called no excuse clause in the contracting. So I'm not, like I said, we haven't really used it yet, I don't think. And so I'm not going to really get into that, but if we were going to use this no excuse clause, and there's federal money involved, we would need federal approval for that, for use of that language. For any of these that where it's federal money involved as well, we do need to have the incentives and the disincentives, and the B part of the A plus B all needs to be based on a road user cost. And the way that you calculate that road user cost is spelled out in the design guidance memorandum that's noted there. And again, going back to what I started with here was understanding, like, even if, so obviously when you do an incentive, there's an obvious cost to the incentive. If they finish the day early and they make their $12,000, we're literally handing them $12,000. But even if we don't do an incentive, even if we just have a disincentive, what we're doing is we're transferring risk from the department to the contractor. And so we are going to pay for that risk. So even if we don't have like one clear item that we're handing the contractor a check for an incentive, we should recognize that our bid prices are probably going to be higher than if we did not have that disincentive included in the contract. So beyond road closures, even lane closures, we need to be thinking those through. That most projects, I think most designers and most of the folks in construction are pretty aware of the very typical lane closure matrix that shows you what days of the week you're allowed to close lanes for what hours. Sometimes it's seasonal as well. Sometimes it varies by day of the week, depending where you're at. So I think everybody's used to that and working with traffic safety to develop those closure matrices. The other one would just be, and again, it lines up perfect. So the Iron Branch project that we just heard from John and Eric about is a perfect example of the use of this policy and thinking through the options. To, you know, normally you would say, ooh, I really don't want to close 113. It's 113, it's 40,000 vehicles a day. But when you thought through all the options and you thought through the time and the cost and the impact to the traveling public of 6 months of contra flow versus let's rip the Band-Aid off fast. Let's get in, let's get out, and let's do that, But then not just do that, but mitigate that. Pave the detour routes. Do a lot of public outreach. Do brochures. Talk to the media. Those are the things you need to do to rip the Band-Aid off fast. That's not one of my kids, just to be clear. Community outreach, again, I've been talking about that a lot already. So there's no change in the actual policy. Just want to reemphasize that, again, there's a discussion between all the groups. You kind of think it through, and then you really have to work with the community relations group to convey that message to the public. The one other thing that we have, we've seen on a couple projects, and sometimes the project delivery takes so long because, I'm not gonna throw anybody under the bus, there's reasons that things take a long time, right? There's been some projects over the last few years where we had a public workshop, we did our due diligence, we told the world what we were doing, but then we didn't go to construction for 3 or 4 years after that. And then, so half the people forgot what we told them 3 or 4 years ago. So one thing, it's not officially written in the policy, but something the designers should be looking for is if there's a long lag between the last public workshop and the start of construction, particularly on larger projects, you probably want to have an informational meeting to reintroduce the project to the public, explain to them why we haven't been back in so long, and explain a little bit about how we think the project's going to go in construction and go from there. There's a table in the back of the policy called this table A1. This is pre-approved lane closures it's mostly for open-end projects or maintenance activities and certain pre-construction activities like survey or that kind of a thing. I'm not getting into the details today, but just in general, we've loosened some of the restrictions that are in that policy, so we've made it a little more flexible. So we're gonna hopefully that'll let us get our work done. And so again, when the policy is published, again, hopefully this month or next month, those of you who have those kind of activities, make sure you review that table again. If you have any questions, you can come to me. You can come to traffic safety. You can take it to your boss and go through those questions. And again, everything in this policy, this new updated policy, is kind of tweaking the 2016 policy. So hopefully it's not a giant change. And that's what I got. Any questions? All right. Thank you, folks.
Hey, Pam, Mark was actually on time 15 minutes, no longer, and he did exactly the planned amount of time. Okay, our next presenter is Mark Harbeson. He has the next two presentations, and his first one is signage by contract, and then right after that, he'll be doing the traffic signal construction update.
Green button. All right, I can't see my own slides. Okay, good morning, my name is Mark Harbeson. I am the traffic field operations manager. I am up here to speak this morning because my boss voluntold me to be up here. And I'm gonna be honest with you, I'm really not happy with the way that went down. As you know, last year, our longtime chief traffic engineer, Mark Lutz, finally gave up on us and took a new position. And so late in the year, Peter Haig became the new chief traffic engineer. So when he assigned me this presentation, I had only been working for him for about a week. And so we're still in that feeling out period, you know, where I'm trying really hard to make a good impression on him, first of all. And then most crucially, I didn't know yet if he was the kind of boss where I could actually say what I'm thinking in front of him and he would appreciate that or not. And that really changed how the conversation went. So what I thought I could do is I could tell you how this conversation went, and then up here on the screen, I'm going to show you what we were actually thinking at the time, all right? Now, I haven't talked to Peter about this, but I'm pretty sure I got it right. So if you can imagine, I'll set the scene for you. I'm sitting in my cubicle at the TMC, and if I can get this going, I'm hard at work on some of the complex issues that we face in traffic every day, okay? And then Peter comes by and knocks on my wall, and he says, Mark, can I speak to you in my office for a minute? Which, you know, is always top five on things you want to hear from your boss. But again, I'm trying to make a good first impression, so I said, absolutely, I'll be right down, no problem. So then we get into his office, and Peter's got this weird glint in his eyes, and he says, I've decided to give you a brand new assignment, okay? To which I say, no problem, whatever you want me to do, Peter, I'm your man. And so he says, all right, well, I've decided to sign you up to be a presenter at the Winter Workshop. To which I say, oh, that's good. Thank you for doing that, Peter. So at this point, I've got my phone out under the desk, and I'm frantically texting Mark Luszcz to see if maybe he can somehow get me out of this. So here's the response I get from him. So, thanks, Mark. That's awesome. 1 week and I'm already dead to him. At this point, Peter has noticed my hesitation over the whole public speaking thing. So he says, now, you weren't planning on spending the entire Winter Workshop hiding in the back and eating a free lunch, were you? And I said, no. Only a loser would do that. And so he gets that weird glint in his eye again. And he says, well, I'm really glad to hear you say that, Mark, because I've actually signed you up to do two presentations back to back. Oh, what a wonderful opportunity. Thank you. Then he kicked me in the shin. So like I said, I'm still trying to figure him out. But anyway, thank you for the opportunity to speak this morning. I am really excited to be here and share with you what we're... Oh, I should probably turn this off. So this is the traffic field operations group that I manage. We have approximately 70 people on staff in these three groups. There's signal construction, which builds all of our traffic signals. Signal maintenance, which maintains the operation of our signals. And not only that, but all of our intelligent transportation system networks. So it's cameras, it's monitoring equipment, weather stations, all sorts of stuff. They have a very difficult job, and they do that 24/7. And then we're going to dive into this first presentation of the signing and markings group, which is exactly what it sounds like, pavement markings and road signs. This is the group under signing and markings. So pavement markings is Donnie Ziegler's group, and signing is under Eric Ball, and this is managed by Nick Mogul. He took over for Bob Hudson, who retired last year. Under signing, we have two groups. We have sign installers, and we have the sign shop for fabrication. So here's the sign installer group. And we estimate that we have well over 300,000 signs on our roads today. That is not an exact number. We don't know the exact number. If I was going to be a betting man, I would probably take the over on that. There's a lot of signs out there. There's more coming every day. The sign installers work around the clock. They're on call. You might think, what's the big deal? If a sign gets knocked down, that can probably wait. But if you think about it, intersections are some of our most dangerous sites on our roads. And if you lose a stop sign, then you've just lost your traffic control at the intersection, and you could be presenting a hazardous situation. So if we get word that a stop sign gets knocked down, for example, we've got to go out and replace it right away. We also do some proactive maintenance with reflectivity. Our sign materials tend to degrade over time. The life is estimated to be about 10 years. Depends on if it's facing south into the sun or west, so on and so forth. So we drive around at night and check reflectivity as part of our proactive maintenance to see if we can get these things up to standards. And then there are also special projects that come along. We have our horizontal curve studies. We have legislative requests, neighborhoods, public requests at all are looking for it to get signs out there. On the fabrication side, we have 8 people working in the sign shop. And those 8 people are responsible for the vast majority of those 300,000 signs out there. So they have a ton of work they have to do, keeping our signs in good shape and in correct position. They have a lot of stock signs they make because people keep hitting them, knocking them down. So we've got to keep replenishing yield signs, stop signs, all the normal signs we use all over the place. And they also make the vast majority of the signs for our capital projects. So every time we have a new project, a request comes in, we have to make the signs for them. And I'll get into that in a little bit. And then again, those legislative requests, public requests, neighborhoods, businesses, so on, they all make requests to us, and sometimes we accommodate those. Now, another role our signing group has gotten into is kind of like the guardians of the MUTCD. So we have to work on making sure that everything is compliant in our state right away with the MUTCD. So one of the types of requests we get that we're constantly discussing is this type of sign. A lot of byways groups, scenic highways, historic sites, tourist destinations, that sort of thing, they want to put up sort of wayfinding signs to give people a roadmap to get to where their attraction or to follow the road for the byway. And again, there's some gray areas in the MUTCD on this for wayfinding, so sometimes, you know, we get beaten into submission and put these things out there. But when we object to these things, it's not because we don't understand your artistic vision on this. All right, well, I'm an engineer. I probably don't understand it, but they get a lot of these designs that are very elaborate, use a lot of colors, have these tiny letters and all. And the problem with these things is that if you're driving along at 50 miles an hour and you see this on the road, you start looking at it going, is that a building or in a donut? What's the letters say? And the longer you're staring at this sign, the longer your eyes are off the road, which is not what we want. So when we push back on these things, that's where we're coming from, is that we're trying to make these things simple and clear and easy to follow so you can get your eyes back on the road where it belongs. We're also not an advertising agency. Apparently, these are actual signs that somebody put up on our posts that we had to go and remove. But it's not our job to advertise businesses. We get pushback on that. People say, don't you support tourism in this state? Don't you support small businesses? And yes, we love those things, but it's not for the state right away. So at various points during the year, we'll get requests to do things like this, and we have to unfortunately say no. We even got a request to sign an entire trail of brew pubs in Delaware. Which, you know, when you're sitting in a brew pub slamming a few beers, we definitely want you getting behind the wheel of your car and driving to the next one. So you have to worry about the message you send with these things and also setting a precedent. If I sign for one business, now I have to sign for all of them. Now, this doesn't include the blue signs you see at freeways, you know, the food, gas, lodging. Those are actually managed through a private company called Delaware Logos, and there are strict policy requirements on what businesses can and can't be on those signs. Lastly, we get asked to put up signs as deterrents. You know, somebody's not parking in the right place, people are trespassing in the wrong place, and again, we can accommodate some of those kinds of requests as long as we keep our expectations in check. Because if you're not going to enforce it, then this might as well be what you're putting up out there. So again, we can do that, we can say no parking, but if you're not gonna bother looking at it, maybe the sign's not the best idea. So this is the type of sign you'll typically see out there. Again, it's very clear, very concise, easy. Some might call it boring, but that's okay. You get the information you need quickly and you get back on the road. Even something like this, I think, is an excellent example. It's very clear, very concise. I wouldn't change a thing about this. All right, now we get all that filler material. Now we get to what I was actually supposed to talk about in this. So currently, we have a process by which capital projects request signs from our sign shop to be fabricated. So the project, it'll be the construction engineer, the inspector, or even the contractor foreman. will contact our sign shop and give us an order for the signs for the project. They usually send us the plans, the sign schedule, and then it's up to our guys to put that together and come up with start fabricating with the signs for the project. We generally have a 4 to 8 week lead time. There's a backlog on these things. Your project is not the only one out there. And we do it first come, first served. And then at the end of that period, when the signs are ready, we will contact the project. Usually the contractor comes and picks up those signs, and then we do a very thorough check. We have every single sign accounted for. We go through it with the contractor to say, these are all the signs you ordered. Check it off a list. You sign off that you got them, because once they leave our shop, it's your problem. That's in your hands. There are common issues with that process right now. That 4 to 8 week lead time can cause some headaches with projects. Sometimes if the sign order didn't get in until late, you forgot about it. If there's a lot of projects in the queue, maybe we're heading a little bit more towards that 8 week time than the 4 week time, and that's not gonna work for your schedule. Something along those lines. So the delays can be a problem, and it actually has proven to be somewhat of a convenient scapegoat for contractors. If they're behind on other things on projects, they could say, well, we're still waiting on the signs because they haven't been delivered yet. So that has created some issues for us. Another popular claim is that the contractors are missing signs. They say, well, the sign shop never gave that one to us. We don't have it. That was one reason why we instituted that whole check process when they pick up the signs a couple of years ago, in order to try and get rid of that problem, to say, look, it's your responsibility once it leaves this building. And then one hidden delay that you probably aren't aware of is that our staff has to spend a lot of time trying to interpret the plans and create the sign order themselves. So, you know, you like to think that the plans and the sign schedule are basically the order form, but it's actually not. They have to constantly go back and forth between those two documents and figure out exactly what we need. There might be some errors on there that they have to call the designer and figure out whose project it is, and then figure out what the correct sign is on the plan. Or they actually may have to do some layouts and actually design the sign themselves in the shop. So all that can create problems for projects too. So we've worked with construction on this, and we're gonna have a new process for signing. We worked a lot with Javier on this. He was a big proponent of this, and it took longer than we thought it was gonna be, so I told him this was gonna be his retirement gift, giving him this new process. So signing is now going to be the responsibility of a contractor on capital projects. It will be a normal bid item, so you'll have to make sure you include it as part of the bid package on your project. And the contractor is gonna have to find a private fabricator to go out and make the signs for these capital projects. We are going to transition some of our sign installation staff, and this has already started to take place, to start assisting with inspections on capital projects. So we've gotten our staff onto the distribution lists for semifinal and final inspections, and we are sending them out to take a look at the projects, inspect the signing, make sure it's done correctly, and then give notes for the punch list if needed, so that we can ensure that this is still being done according to the METCD. And our sign fabrication staff is still gonna be available as a resource. We have asked the designers to start taking more responsibility on laying out the signs. We bought Flexi design software for our traffic design staff, and they're actually doing more of the layouts now. We've been working hand in hand with them to show them how to use the software to follow some of the rules that we follow for laying out signs. This is on the Design Resource Center. Might be a little hard to see up there, but if you go to the MUTCD page on the Design Resource Center, you can see that smaller circle on the bottom is the Delaware Sign Book. So this was a huge effort we went through. Of course, you have the federal MUTCD, which is all the federally mandated signs that we use, that we follow. The Delaware Sign Book here is something that we put together for all the standard signs that we use in the state of Delaware. So it's kind of a supplement. And so this is where you can find that material. And then right above that, right now it's listed under general. It should probably be under the signs, so we might want to change that. But those three documents that I circled there are memos that we have laid out for how you lay out some hard to do signs, you know, where they don't quite fit. Street name signs, you can have some weird names, some long names, and if you strictly follow the rules, you end up with like 7 foot long street blades, which we're not gonna do. So we have some best practices to follow here in order to figure out how to do your sign layout properly. So all those materials are available and up on the DRC. If you open the Delaware sign book, here's a sample page there. So you can see we've done a layout. This is obviously a very Delaware specific sign. You can see we've got the colors we use, we've got the materials, we've got all the dimensions. And then if you see where I've circled in the corner, there's a download button there. Excuse me, and that actually has several electronic versions of this layout. There's a PDF, there's a Flexi file, there's a MicroStation file, and there's one more that I'm forgetting at the moment. But all the most commonly used file formats for sign layouts are contained here in that link. So hopefully that will make it very easy for a transition for designers to use. And we're hoping this covers at least like 95% of the signs. Shout out on this to Bobby McNamara, the foreman or the sign shop supervisor, Mattia Radovich of Whitman Requart, and David Kleinott of PD worked really hard. There were a lot of IT issues getting this up and running, but we finally got there. So kudos to those guys. As part of our new process, the sign schedule stays the same. There's no changes to that. Just remember, you need to include this as a bid item now. As I said, the designers, it's traffic in design, and also our consultants are going to be doing the sign layouts. We've put out the Flexi software, and we also rewrote the specs for the 2020 update. So we've gone and edited the specs to make sure that that shifts the burden of responsibility for the signs onto the contractor. And basically, that's going to be our grandfather period. We took this to the PD working group, and that was a consensus there, was that if your project comes out and it's under the old specs, then DelDOT is still fabricating the signs for it. Once the new specs are out, if your project has the new specs, then it's going to follow the new process. So we tried to make that as simple as possible. Benefits of doing this, it should clean up a lot of the responsibilities on capital projects. We're hoping that this gives construction full control of the project. You can set the deadlines, you can tell your contractor when this has to be done, and there's no gray areas or muddled responsibilities here anymore. So we're hoping that that's the big benefit for construction. Our sign shop will have less of a backlog. We're not calling to ask, you know, which project of the eight you just sent is the priority, and then hearing back, well, they're all priorities. You know, that's kind of like the Incredibles. If everyone is special, then no one is. The same kind of principle there. So it helps us to turn around our backlog faster. And then we can concentrate more on our maintenance because there's signs getting knocked down every day that we have to constantly keep up with. So it should benefit us there. And then eventually we are hoping to get a better signing inventory. And that's like, you know, a huge task with 300,000 plus signs out there. But we'd really love to get to that point where we know what's out there, when it was placed, how old it is, and be able to get a little bit more of a proactive maintenance process going on our signs. All right, with that, that's all I have on signing, and I will be happy to take any questions you may have on this at this point. Ken?
Is it a breakout sheet? What you're doing, a lump sum with a breakout sheet for all signs, and that's how they're gonna bid it, or what?
We have not come up with a breakout sheet. Again, there is a sign schedule in the traffic statement, and I know that's not part of the bid documents, but we had started down the road on doing a breakout sheet, and then in talking with construction, they kind of pulled back from that and just said, you know, let's just give the documents out there. We've actually done this before on some projects where contractors have provided signs for it, and they were just provided the materials that we currently do in the bid package, and they go and create the order form themselves. So we are leaving that up to the contractor. I don't recall offhand what the spec called for the bid item, but I'll check on that. All right, thank you. So moving right along. Hi, I'm Mark Harbeson. You may remember me from such winter workshop presentations as the one I just did. It was also called How to Commit Career Suicide by Publicly Throwing Your Boss Under the Bus. So it's been good working with you guys. Just to give you deja vu, here's the group I manage again. We are going to be diving into the signal construction side a bit on this. Thank God Peter forgot about signal maintenance, or I'd be doing three presentations. Here's the group for signal construction. Eddie Tolson is the supervisor of this group. It consists of construction inspectors whose job is to go out and enforce the specs on all of our traffic signals. And then there are three signal techs, and their job is to basically build the signal cabinets and program the controllers and make sure that the signal timings are all correct and get the system up and running the way it should be. We have a couple different processes we follow in traffic depending on the type of project it is. We have a lot of traffic-only projects. So these are basically rebuilding signals, new signals, putting out pedestrian signals and crosswalks for upgrades, traffic monitoring devices. These are all things that are generated in-house in traffic where our design staff under Max Santil puts these together. They create all the plans for it, and then they turn into what we call a handoff package, and that goes straight to our group in signal construction, where then we turn it around and build the project. We have three open-end construction contracts right now with contractors. Byers, Chris, and Rommel are our three contractors. We have a very quick process for doing this. Because it's open-end, it's kind of an innovative process that we follow where the contractors submitted their bid prices for all of our commonly used items right at the front when we opened this project. And then when we get a handoff package, we take the items and quantities for that package and we run it through those previously submitted bid prices, and then whoever the low bidder happens to be for that particular project gets assigned the task. This enables us to really turn things around quickly and start construction very fast. It's usually within a month of getting that handoff package. The same contractor handles all the work. So when we assign it to Byers or Chris, they take the project, they do all the underground work, all the conduit, pulling cables, trenching, so on and so forth. They do the concrete, pole bases, and then they do the aerial work as well. There's usually a couple of different crews that work on these different types of work. But everything above ground is also handled by our contractor. So we control it from start to finish. Capital projects are a different story. So we receive the handoff package. Usually it's when the project goes out and is awarded. Not always the case. Sometimes the project might be a two-year project and they might not need us until further down the line. So there could be changes to the plans, something along those lines. So sometimes we get the handoff package much later than the project has actually been awarded. It may have already been started. So it really depends on the project. The responsibilities are split. So the general contractor for the capital project handles all the underground work. So they're doing the conduit runs, they're doing the concrete work for the pole bases, et cetera, et cetera. And then we come in with our traffic contractor and we do the aerial work. So the reason for this is because the general contractor usually has to do conduit, concrete, all these items they use for several other aspects of the project. And so they've submitted a bid price and we'll usually get a much better price for that work. Whereas the aerial work is usually special for traffic, we've already got bid prices under our open ends, and therefore we can have our contractor just go in and do the work under those prices. It's going to work out a lot better for the department that way. So that's how we've done it for years and years and years. So you've decided to build a traffic signal. So let's look at how this process has worked in practice. And just wanted to basically highlight some of the issues that we run into. And again, we're not making any changes to the process right now, but as we just talk about some of the things we run into on projects that I'm hoping we can work and make things run even more smoothly in the future. Oftentimes, our inspectors are not there on site when the underground work is happening on a capital project. They try and check in periodically, but they've also been assigned several projects at once. So they're moving around, touching base on their different projects from time to time, and may not be there when this work is happening. So it's really important that the correct materials are used for conduit runs, the correct connections are made. There can only be certain types of connections between materials. I was told a story one time, we saw somebody used an old Coke can to make a connection between conduits, which we admire the ingenuity, but it's not really up to spec. That all needs to happen, and oftentimes we won't see it. But if we get on site and we can't pull our cable through the conduit, then it's going to delay the project and cause a problem. Same with the pole bases. When you pour those, we usually provide the anchor bolts. Somebody comes and picks them up, and then they go out and pour the pole base for the project. Those anchor bolts have to be set in specific patterns in order for the pole base to work and the pole to be able to set on it properly. And if it doesn't, then we've disturbed the site. We can't reuse it, so we have to knock out that pole base and find a different site for a new pole base to be poured, which really can cause delays on a project. So it's critical to get that right the first time. We are happy to be there. I've talked with Eddie about this. We will do the best we can. If you notify us that you're pouring concrete on such and such a day for a pole base, we'll be happy to come and watch over it and check the template and make sure that it's in properly. All right, sometimes we get calls that we need you there today. You've got to be here right away to do this traffic signal work. And we get it. We're in construction. We understand things happen quickly. Things change all the time. And sometimes you need immediate answers. So if we push back on that, here's some of the reasons why. There's a lot of things that happen behind the scenes in traffic you may not be aware of that cause us not to be able to turn on a dime all the time. For one thing, we have to make an application for electrical service from the power companies, from Delmarva Power or DEC. We have to apply for the service, and then their crews actually have to come out and build the service meter to supply power. We've been doing this for a lot of years, and what we have learned is that our traffic signals are not nearly as effective when they do not have power. So it's a critical item to get right. And sometimes, depending, again, if we don't get that service application in on time, that could cause a delay. Will Newcomb of Century works with our construction department every day. He's been kind of our one-stop shop for electrical service applications. So we funnel everything through him. He has good connections with the power companies. And that process, for the most part, has seemed to work very well, where we've been able to get good responses from the power companies. But this is something that needs to happen well in advance of getting a signal turned on. Timesheets are important, and this involves the TMC. They control all of the signal timings for our signals. So again, it takes time to do the calculations and make sure we get the proper signal timings. That has to be in place before we can get the signal turned on. They may need a new timesheet for a different MOT phase as well. It's not just the final timing. But if you're changing the lanes, changing the shifts, you might be shifting traffic signal heads, and then you might need a new timesheet depending on what lanes you have open at the time. So all of this, again, has to happen in advance. This also involves our signal technicians. Remember I said there's three of those guys in this group. They're the ones building the cabinet. They put all the electronics and equipment, the controllers, the monitors, and all together. And then they have it running in the shop in test mode. They have to test all the data. We try and download it from the TMC to make sure the correct signal timings are there and it works properly and there's no hiccups. They usually need a few days to get that test run done. So again, this is something that could cause problems if we're getting last minute notice. And then finally, traffic safety also has to be notified with, you know, changes in phases, lane closures, et cetera, et cetera. In our group, we are working on a 2-week look-ahead schedule. We have tried to work with the contractor and work with our signal techs on this schedule. So our contractors can only be in one place at one time. Typically, one of them only has one aerial crew. So it's a little bit like herding cats, trying to schedule them to get all these jobs done. So that's why we try and do this look-ahead schedule to see, okay, let's get you here on this date, and try and get as much advance notice as we can so we can plan this out and juggle all the work we have to do. And same with our signal techs. We have to get them scheduled in advance so they know where they need to be. You know, they've got families, they've got lives, and it's very difficult to say, hey, I need you at midnight tonight on the last day, and expect them to always be available. It's just not realistic. So again, that look-ahead schedule has really helped us out to try and plan this ahead. Now, of course, it's going to get messed up with weather delays and so on and so forth. It is construction, but we're trying the best we can to hold to that schedule. So I wanted to put that out there just to say, if you can work with us on this, try and look ahead and give us advance notice when you need some of these other issues that I talked about, I think it'll go a lot smoother. The capital projects are our highest priority in this group. That direction has come down from on high all the way down. We all support that. So generally, if there's a conflict between one of our projects and a capital project, the capital project's going to win that battle, and we're going to go and support it. But we're just trying to make this work smoothly as possible. At the moment, I just put this, when I wrote this slide, we had 62 total projects on our to-do list. That's combined, that we're trying to schedule the work between these three contractors. So that's why I say when we're juggling all these things, this is kind of the workload that we're having to face. Maybe it just feels this way, but when we look at all the issues we've had, it feels like well over 99% of them could have been boiled down to communication issues, where somebody's not talking to somebody, somebody's not giving enough notice, somebody's not thinking ahead and saying, hey, we really need this to happen, and reaching out. As we know, communication is two-way, so the issues come up on both sides. I'm working really hard with Eddie and our group to be as proactive as possible, to understand that our phone works just as well as their phone. We can call them. We can reach out and ask questions. So we're working hard to try and be much better communicators. I hope that we can all do that together, because I think that's going to solve a lot of the problems we face. With that, once again, I'm open to any questions you may have. All right, thank you.
Thanks, Mark. I don't think anyone will ever think the same of Peter Haig again after all that. Our next presenter is James Osborne, or Jim Osborne, or Oz, or as Phil Horsey recently said, Ozzy. And he'll be talking about the 2020 specification updates and standard construction detail updates. And it's only part one, people. After lunch, we will have part two.
Good morning. Learned quite a bit this morning so far. Gold-plated guardrail. I think we're gonna cross that off the list. If you sit in the back, you still get free lunch. Voluntold does happen. I feel that. I'm up here for the first time, been winter workshops quite a bit sitting out there, so I completely understand Mark's conversation there. Automated vehicles, that's gonna be interesting when that comes about. That's gonna help with the brewery signs that we're gonna have. So 2020, we just did the 16s. I know it's kind of recent. I kind of came into the office knowing that this is going to happen, and it was more of a language aspect change. The numbers are going to stay the same. We want to try to keep the estimation of proportion of it so we can do the contracts, keep numbers for specifications, not create where 16s actually opened up into more of the traffic items, created some new items, created some new shifting, made some conflicts between the 2001 and 2016. This time around, this is more of just an updated version of it, as well as a language change in essence. Let's see if I get this right. So currently, we're working on the Division 100 in review. 200 has been shared. 3, 2, 3, 4, 5 has been shared with DCA as well as internally to kind of go over the summaries, where we've changed, the languages. 600 is being created, the summary. We've worked with Troner to help us with the 100s. They've also helped us kind of with the language change throughout this whole section. The 700 summary has been shared. The 900 summary has been shared. And the 800 is being worked on, as Mark mentioned, with the signage. That's going to happen in the 800 section. It's going to kind of answer the question of how that's going to be paid. We currently pay it by the sign and by the post and by the hardware. We will continue doing that, and in aspects, the only difference is we'll be paying not only for the install, we'll be paying for the material and install. Slight change, but nothing major in that sense. There was a couple things. I did do a little bit of digging just to find out what sort of expectations there would be for different languages. I kind of found this online and wanted to share a little bit. So if we were looking at 600s, one of the things that you could say is for pipe, all pipe fittings are to be made of the same stuff pipe is. If the pipe is over 500 foot in length, the words must be on it, long pipe. If the pipe is over 2 miles, you must have written in the middle of it, is two, that's long pipe. For the fitter should know that it's this long pipe. If the pipe is hollow throughout the entire length, is that a good spec? No. But again, that's what we're trying to create, is something that is legible for the individual that is using the spec. So the new specs are going to be written to the contractor. We've tried to remove the passive voice in that essence and make it more active voice with an imperative mode. That's something that Troner kind of helped us work through, and they created this language. And it's not really a change in how we've said it, it's just a change of what we're saying and who we're saying it to. So we're not talking to the individual creating the project, we're talking to the individuals building the project. And we're also trying to discuss this in a language that's understood by the contractor building the project. One of the things in active voice. So there's a lot of different examples on this behalf, but instead of saying Sam cooks the food, well, we're writing this contract, we're writing the spec for the contractor. So Sam is the contractor. So we're telling the contractor, we're giving them directions, cook the food. How they cook the food, if we want to get into that, then we need to actually say, we expect you to cook the food with electric or gas. Those are the things that we're trying to implement into the language of the specs. And that was the change of the 2020. That's kind of the moving forward in that perspective. We're also trying to make them more readable, not as open to interpretation. So something that everyone can read, theoretically, everyone should be able to read it and have the same interpretation. I say theoretically because no matter how often or how much we work on this, we're still going to have some open or questions. So the imperative mode, the example is no smoking. We're not really giving an opinion. We just need to say it with a smile, while he does up here. So we're not trying to give a question of doubt of what we're wanting the contractor to do. We want him to build it. We want him to excavate it. We want him to put the sidewalk in, what our expectations are. So moving from that essence, we've also tried to remove a little bit of extra language within the spec. We use the word quite a bit of incidental. So that was a thing that we try to take out of what is incidental. Currently, these are search numbers that I found. We haven't finished all the sections yet, but we're already under 50, quite a bit under 50, so I kind of rounded up a little bit of the word incidental. So incidental has its place, but it doesn't have to go everywhere. Before, we used it quite a bit to catch all. I had an interesting conversation just the other day, or last week, about the 211 section for concrete removal. Well, in it, it reads within the bottom of the paragraph, it says incidental. So removal of concrete and all activities incidental too. So does saw cutting include removal? Because you have to saw cut in order to remove it. But yet, what are we saw cutting? We're saw cutting hot mix, we're saw cutting concrete. In feeding off that aspect of it, what are we filling the hole back in with? Is that considered incidental? So again, that's what we're trying to be a little more specific to the matter of. Okay, we're removing it according to the 211 spec. We're going to reestablish it according to the 900 for seating and and topsoiling. So we're just trying to be a little more specific to the contractor what our expectations are and kind of get rid of that questionability. Now there are places that we do use incidental and we will continue using incidental that need to be there. An example may be the 700 section for 701 and the curb and sidewalk, where excavation and stone are actually included into the square footage because we pay for the surface square footage, not the excavation of it. So if we're doing 6 inches of sidewalk, we're doing 6 inches of GABC. It means you have to excavate 12 inches. So it's part of, and it is included, but yet it's not questioned. It's more of a footprint of method of how is the contractor going to excavate it, what are they going to use to excavate it, how are they going to get in to excavate it. So we kind of leave, that's where we want to leave those items open to the contractor to make the decision of how to move that forward. Another thing we try to do is improve readability. The 401 section right now is basis of payment. We then did a supplemental that says replace the first paragraph. So the way moving forward, we want it to be kind of listed out, not just a paragraph, saying that the department will pay for, the department will make adjustments, the department will consider quantity of safety edges incidental to the paving items. So it's not within it. So something that is, it's a little easier to read, a little more direct, you don't have to search for it. And we're gonna kind of go into the format to help with the searching proportion of that conversation. So the format. Right now, we kind of follow the same format, title, description, materials, construction, method of measurement, and basis of payment. The difference is there was a lot of things that we had that were in method of measurements that had nothing to do with measuring. They may have been a conversation of how to pay for it, or may have been a spin-off of the construction. So we want to make sure that if you're talking about how to measure it, that we're not telling the contractor that we're not paying for something. So we're kind of, and we have a few examples to try to help with that. So the description, short and brief, that should, instead of the paragraph long, a 401, work system providing and placing bituminous payment. The rest of it is in the construction aspect of it. If we don't know what bituminous payment is, then I guess we'll have to Google at that point in time. But you can get a lot more description from that point. We just want to be brief to the point. Now we're doing a lot of things with the specifications as they are standards, so at some point in time we're going to have to revisit a lot of our specials as well. Materials, again, what materials are being used? It could be anywhere from the 901 section that has zero materials, it's more of a inspection quality, or into the 501 that has everything from insulation blankets to curing compounds, adding water, fly ash. It can get pretty extensive in that sense. And so we want to make sure the materials within that specification are listed within that section. To 2016 with constructability, an example was the 401 section. Just kind of put in there, we added a few things, changed a few things around. As you can see from the listing, we kind of, in the 2020, we put a before paving. So that's something that's going to be a little different in fashion that we want to make sure we have a pre-pave conversation. And then the material production, again, this is to the contractor about constructability, not to the plant on construction, on product. So that's in a different, that's going to be in a whole different section. It's not really going to be in a specification to the contractor. That's to the product, that's to the supplier. Surface tolerances, we just kind of renamed that to a wearing surface. But again, so everything kind of stayed the same. We kind of gave some information in there. We tried to condense it down. Hopefully we've reduced a few pages, got rid of a few extras. Method of measurement, again, an example was not a measurement item. In the curb, any curb showing cracks shall have the length of 10 feet, not at no cost to the department. Again, that's more of a basis of payment. Is that we're not gonna pay for things that are damaged, but that's also reversed down to, we have a 100 section. And in that 100 section, it actually in 104, it's 15 now, I believe in the 16, it may actually go to 104.16. The contractor's responsibility for the work. So it's their work, they're doing their due diligence, they need to provide a good service. If the concrete cracks because of they didn't saw cut in time, they didn't put the relief joints in, that's all part of their responsibility for the work. Instead of saying that many, many times throughout the spec that we have in the past, we've tried to reduce that response, that repetition. It was in there, we used it quite a bit. Now, instead of referring to the spec item specifically, it's gonna be referred to 104. 104 states, Mr. Contractor, you are responsible for the work. Again, we have some information in here in the 701 section for crack and damaged curbs. Now, just for, as a look forward in the 700 section, I think it used to be 10 feet for all joints, but we've allowed up to 4 feet in the past. So instead of creating a conversation in the field for subjectivity, we've said then, okay, if we're allowing 4 feet, then let's put 4 feet in the spec. Say 4 feet is the minimum, 10 feet is the maximum. And we have done that moving in the 700 section. The last basis of payment, last section, is in the 2020, is basically going to be listed out a little bit more. It's a little easier to read. It kind of goes with that readability aspect of it. Hopefully it's easier to find. We are going more digital. I think most everyone in the field is going to have, we use Unifier, so we have iPads, we have that digital aspect, we have that digital capability of searching. And so it's not going to be a book that we're opening up anymore. Now it's still producible, but it's still in a print version, but we are actually producing this in more of a digital world moving forward. So looking ahead, the sections that we're reviewing, we're still looking at the 100s. We hope to have something out here very shortly on that behalf. I say end of this month, beginning of March. And we have something that we can actually discuss and talk about, as well as the rest of the section. So we want to be able to have this out in play this year. We hope we're a little ahead, a little further ahead than what we are. But there's also been, I will have to extend a lot of thanks out to the support sections to look at these particular areas. I mean, there's some very specific items that are needed, like the 600 sections is very heavily built on structures, very, we've had to reach out to all the sections to provide the support for anywhere from the guardrail, the traffic, concrete construction, striping. The specs encompass a lot and a lot of individuals, so there's definitely a lot moving forward. Now, looking ahead, again, like I kind of breached into, we are looking at the fashion that the books were in two different. We had the standards and we had the supplementals. The supplementals were, if you had two different monitors on sitting at your desk, it worked out really well. You can do a comparison. But sometimes it was forgotten about. So something that had changed in the standards didn't change in the supplementals. But did we actually review those two sides? So you had to make sure that you had to look at each one. Sometimes we reverted back, something that we started in the 16s. I think the all work was incidental to the pipe. That got pulled out of there in the supplemental, saying that, well, we pay for excavation, we pay for borrow. And we've tried to clarify some of those aspects up with the 2020. But again, looking at that aspect of it, it was easy to forget to look at the supplementals and see that we did that. Being that we are in digital, we are using iPads. Sorry, that's a bad picture of an iPad, but you know, kind of we use them. We want to make sure that we produce the 2020 and any supplementals that we move forward with follow the digital age of one single document. We'll have an addendum in the back kind of showing that. So we are going to kind of change how we move these supplementals forward. So that it's a single document, a little easier to read, a little easier to find, a little less searching. So if you know the contract age that's being the bid proposal at time of, you can just pull that one up, work with that, and not have to search back and forth. Okay, which one did we change? Which one did we do? Now, there is going to be some lag over. We're still, we just sent out the last 2001 specification late last year. So we still have contracts that are going to be working under the 2001 specs. We're going to have contracts working under 16 specs. And here shortly, we're going to have contracts working 2020. 2020, we're not changing any of the numbers. We'll say that much. We're just changing the way the language is being placed. So that should help in the transition to probably bleed over a little quicker into the 16, from 16 to 2020. Hopefully we've made some improvements because there's been a lot of effort being put down by a lot of different individuals to help with that. And I will have to say thank you for that. And by creating making this a little easier to read, a little more constructible, a little bit better in that perspective, we should be able to move this one forward, hopefully sooner than that. And I know specifications is really exhilarating and lots of questions, and hopefully not. I feel Mark's pain with that. I don't want any questions. But if there is any, I will have details later on this afternoon, and that will be just as exciting as this one. Any questions?
Any chance we can get the ticket control from the construction manual moved into the standard specs so the contractors know our expectations when we're auditing tickets?
So the question was ticket control from the constructions into the standard specs. Right now, I think that's still in the process of discussion, Jeremy. I think one of the dilemmas that we have, too, is we have to get things that we have to ensure that it works before it gets implemented in there. And I think that we're still working on making that happen because the contractors, do they all have that ticket control? If we put it in there that everyone has to produce it and have it, then everyone has to have it and we have to enforce it. So are we across the board able to do that may be the question. So that's one of the things that we're trying to do in the supplementals or in the specifications is that we need to make sure it's across the board, not something that is for a specific project. So if it's project specific, we need to make that project specific. It could be in the construction manual, could be in the bid proposals, could be in the plans. Again, I think I know what you're speaking of, but in the same, I don't think we're quite there in getting it into the standards as of yet, but it's definitely coming down the way. The contractors have to have that availability of producing that part of it. Are we talking about the digital aspect of it or the actual digital?
Well, printed tickets and such like that, and mostly when contractors are utilizing DBEs, trucking, to meet their DBE goals, there's additional information that are needed on tickets for the DBE office as well as Federal Highway to be able to recreate the paper trail that the DBE trucking companies are actually being utilized like they're
Well, I know a lot of that information, and I apologize, is not specifically to the contractor on construction aspect of it. So maybe something that we can venture into if it is, it's more of a general contractor for like the 100 section. It wouldn't be something that would be implemented directly to that. I don't think we've looked at that specifically because we're trying to get everything to work. And DBEs are based off of the contract itself because it's in the bid proposals. So not everyone has the same DBE requirements. So it's kind of hard to lay that blanket across there. It's definitely something we can take a look at a little bit further, and I'll take some notes. And
definitely.
Okay. Any other questions? Excellent. Thank you very much.
All right. Our last presenter before our break is the facility update by Taylor King.
All right, good morning, everybody. My name is Taylor King. I'm the Facility Program Manager for Maintenance and Operations, and I'm between you and some good food, so we're going to make this snappy. So our biggest project this year is the Bear Administration Building, demolition and reconstruction. Excited to say we got good bids back last week, and so we're currently doing the analysis and hoping to award. We're doing something a little different. We reached out to a well-known demolition contractor who's going to help us out. Secretary Cohan and Deputy Secretary Majeski are very excited to participate in the demolition. Boom. A little throwback to the original. But obviously everybody is very, very excited for this new project to get underway. So the new 24,000 square foot office building features 21st century design principles, a high performance building envelope, ample natural lighting with daylit views. Office areas feature open workspaces, glass enclosed offices, hoteling spaces, and floor to ceiling perimeter windows. The first floor features a naturally lit lobby with a service desk and information screens for our customers. The second floor features office space, conference areas, and an 800 square foot break room opening up to outdoor rooftop seating. We anticipate construction to take about 2 years. So where are we now? Just 2 miles down the road, canal maintenance staff, right-of-way staff, and DOTS North Construction have moved into our office at 248 Chapman, right between I-95 and 273. So some of our other facility projects have been happening. St. George's Maintenance Yard, you guys probably see it going over the Roth Bridge. Area 22 moved into the crew quarters and maintenance shop back in December. And we're hoping to have the site fully operational in the spring when we finish the material storage pad. Construction's progressing on the DOTS North office on Chapman Road, right down the street. We're anticipating the site will be ready to occupy in late spring. Construction's underway at our Chapman Road maintenance yard. We're building a new 3,000 square foot office, 5,000 ton salt barn, and a new OSHA compliant dual use wash platform. We've got some big maintenance shop projects underway right now. Middletown Maintenance Shop under construction in Gravel Hill and Harrington are at 50% plans. We hope to have the Middletown shop completed later this fall, and Gravel Hill scheduled to be completed next summer, and Harrington shop hopefully just a few months after that. We're very excited for the first time to announce our planned expansion of the Georgetown Administration Building. This is a 6,000 square foot expansion. The project will provide needed office space to support our staff in the delivery of extensive transportation infrastructure improvements in Sussex County in the coming years. And we hope to have the project out to bid early next year with construction wrapping up in 2023. So with that, thank you, and everybody enjoy your snack.
All right, goodness, we're way early. It's about 10 o'clock. Our break wasn't scheduled until 10:20, so we'll just take the 20 minutes and just meet back here at 10:20, okay?
timed out at some point, and I just wanted to see if I could turn that on.
Thank you. Yeah. Okay. Scott's asked me to help with the railroad
yeah.
ones.
Yeah, I put
you on there. So I wasn't sure if I, like, since I just got this assignment, I have to memorize anything.
Yeah.
Five-minute warning. We're going to be starting in 5 minutes. All right, if you guys can finish getting your snacks and coffee and water or tea or juices and come back to your seats, we're going to be starting in about 3 minutes.
I'll let you. You're doing well, by the way. It's going very well.
All right, let's wrap it up. Wrap it up. Wrap up your conversations. There'll be plenty of time at lunch and at the second break. And if all goes well, we might get you out a little bit earlier than the 3:30 time frame. So if everyone is expeditious on getting back to their seats, we can start. Okay, if you guys took out your cell phones and were talking and put them on whatever, please remember to put them back on silent or vibrate. Okay, as Mark Buckalew leaves his old job into his new, he's just going to give you one of his last traffic operations type thing, presentation on the MASH overview. So here's Mark.
Thank you, Maureen. Good morning, my beautiful DelDOT family. Thank you for joining us today on one of the most beautiful days of the year. Appreciate you spending time with us. I just wanted to update you on some of the standard detail updates so we can stay MASH compliant. If I could back up a little bit and sort of go over the implementation timeline, and the manual for assessing safety hardware was developed in 2016. Based off of that, the FHWA came up with sunset dates for when our roadside safety hardware has to be updated. And of course, 2017 was the easy one when hardware went from 27-inch to 31-inch. And 2018, W-beam terminals had to be updated. These are the permanent installations for end treatments that ended up getting pushed to 2018. You know, 2018 was supposed to be cable barriers and terminal for cable barriers and crash cushions. That ended up getting pushed as well to 2019 because there weren't any products available for medium barrier. And 2019, this is the big one. So this is the bridge rails transitions, all their longitudinal barriers, including portable barriers installed permanently, all other terminals, signs, supports, or other breakaway hardware. This also includes temporary work zone items. So in the end of 2018, we created the MASH 2016 Update Committee. It was really important that we bring different groups from across the department, members from Bridge, Project Development, Construction, Maintenance, and Consultants, in one group so we could talk about how we want to approach MASH updates. Steve Sisson told me it's pretty boring. I get it, he's right. And we nerd up on guardrail. Again, he's right again. But it's a necessary committee. The intent is to update our standard details. It's a department-wide effort. We don't want something in design, go out in construction, we install it, and then maintenance has problems if one of the roadside hardware gets hit maintaining these products. So if I can go over some of the detail updates, standard B1, sheet 1, some minor revisions, some dimension changes, sheet 2, no changes, and sheet 3, there'll be some revisions to reflect the MASH tested devices. Again, just small dimension changes in the details. Some of the things we're going to add is guardrail on steep slope. It's basically just a longer post. By adding this into our details, it'll give you another tool in our toolbox. I know maintenance or pavement rehab goes out to do a project and they run across some steep slope. This will also cue to have some a way to pay for it, so it'll be a pay mechanism associated with this. Another detail we're going to add is guardrail with one post omission. Just keep that in mind. We can omit one post, omit two, and it's not really match compliant, so we're going to add that detail as well. The reflectors. FHWA brought this up in a conference I was at 6 months ago, that if reflectors installed at the post, it will act as a washer. So when guardrail is installed, you don't want the post attached or the rail attached to the post. So we're going to put the reflectors at the splice point, which is between the posts. So the reason for this is as a vehicle strikes the guardrail, the post rotates backwards and the rail stays up and redirects the vehicle back onto the roadway. If the rail becomes attached to the post when it rotates backwards, the vehicle can then drive over top of the guardrail. So this is a small detail change, but it's very important. Standard B2 grading for guardrail end treatment attenuators. This detail is not going to change too much. It's pretty conservative. We're going to ask that you really follow the manufacturer's recommendations. They may be a little more liberal with their grading detail. If that's the case, feel free to follow that. The contractor can have their choice on what end treatment they choose to use. So they could use a slightly liberal grading detail, but what we're going to have in our plans is the most conservative. So you can really feel free to follow both. I like the BMW, that's why I put it in there. Guardrail over culverts, minor changes to the dimensioning. Just keep in mind the maximum span length is 25 feet. They tried testing over 25 feet and it failed. Standard detail sheet B4 for end anchorage, it's getting replaced. This is the big one. Standard B5, guardrail and barrier attachments. Approach site 131 is going to stay. The 2-31 is going to be replaced. Sheet 6 of 6 will also remain with some minor revisions to the existing sheet. In lieu of the 231 detail, which is the stacked W beam, we're going to develop a 34-inch and a 31-inch thrive beam transition guardrail to barrier. I get what you're saying. Keep changing guardrail every couple years. It's very painful. Finally figured out, we're going to change it again. But this is a federal requirement, and all the states are going through this problem. So I feel your pain. Here's our guardrail 1-31. Keep in mind it was tested with no curb, which means we can't have curb in front of this attachment. But so maximum curb height would have to be 2 inches. That'll help channel the runoff away from the rail, from the post, so we don't get erosion around the posts. So maintain a 2-inch curb height. Just keep that in mind when you're designing these and when you're constructing these. If you see an 8-inch curb reveal on one of these attachments, raise the red flag. This is the tough one. Standard B5 is guardrail barrier connection 2-31. This is a stacked W beam. This detail did not pass MASH. Now, before I show you what I'm going to show you, don't panic. It passed under 350, so certain vehicles it passes under MASH, certain vehicles it failed. This is what happened when they tested the MASH stack W beam. So that's considered a failed test. Just glad they did it with a Dodge. Good. Standard detail B5. This is what it's going to turn into. This is our thrive beam. This is a symmetrical and asymmetrical view of thrive beam attachment, and this is what we're going to go with in our standard details. Standard detail for B6 is the bridge rail retrofits. We have 5 sheets to show different bridge rail retrofits that we can do. Honestly, they're really not applicable. So they're all going to be removed. So anytime we have a bridge rail retrofit, it's basically going to have to be designed intentionally just for that bridge, because honestly, you don't know the structural integrity of that bridge. So bridge is going to have to really be designed for that bridge specific. Section B14 concrete safety barrier. This will be updated. Our minimum height now is going to be 36-inch F-shape for TL4, 42-inch F-shape for TL5, and we're also thinking about adding a 42-inch single slope for TL5. The single slope isn't really used a lot across the state. I talked to Adam Weiser. The only place we really have it is on 273 up near Newark. The TL4 and TL5 is the height, so based on the height, so that's really going to be the designer's call on what they want to use, depending on which section of roadway they're installing this barrier. And we're also looking at developing an AGT, which is an approach guardrail transition for bridge and parapet concrete barrier. This is, it'll be a new detail, which is shown here. Shows the rebar, shows the whole placement for the thri-beam attachment. Many of you on construction understand the pains we go through when you attach guardrail to barrier. Sometimes it has to be twisted. The rub rail ends up getting twisted as we try to tie it into the F shape. It becomes difficult. By having this transition detail, it should solve a lot of our problems. Temporary traffic control devices. This is another one that we have to meet MASH on for work zone devices. We don't have to make adjustments right now. So FHWA basically said we can sunset the old 350 temporary work zone devices until whatever date we choose. So we're working with Delaware Contractors Association to figure out which dates we're gonna put for the end some of these products. So temporary barrier wall. So I'm thinking 2 to 3 years, there's still some good 350 wall out there. We don't wanna just go scrapping a bunch of concrete barrier wall that's still in good shape. Temporary signs, it's pretty cheap. That sunset date's probably gonna be a year. TMAs, again, another large cost product. So we're probably gonna push that out 3 to 5 years. Just keep in mind, whatever we put on the contractors, we're also gonna be putting on maintenance. So we don't wanna cripple maintenance from preventing them from actually putting products on the roadway that they can use. And crash cushions, we'll probably put a 2-year sunset date on that. There's still a lot of 350 temporary crash cushions out there. We don't want to just scrap brand new pieces, brand new products that can still be used. Some of the resources we fall back on, the FHWA eligibility site, Transportation Research Board, and my favorite is Texas A&M Institute, TTI. Unlike Johnny Manziel, they put up a very professional product. It's very useful to the department. We joined this committee, as well as a bunch of other states across the country, and it's really been a home run. So if you're ever interested, you can check it out, theroadsidepooledfund.org. If you need the password, I can give you the password. Since we're a participating state, we're able to get a lot more information from them. Been a tremendous resource for us. They do a lot of crash testing down in Texas, which is pretty neat, expensive. So if there's a product or design that we want tested, we can pay to have that product tested down at TTI. If it's full-scale testing, it's gonna run you about $200,000. So just keep that in mind. But if it's really a need for the department, we have that avenue. I wanna give a special thanks to GPI. Michael Nauman has been phenomenal for us. I'd like to also thank WRA, Adam Weiser, and Todd Oliver. Without the help of those consultants, I'm not sure we'll be able to pull this update off as quickly as we have been. Do we have any questions? No questions on updating our details. Everybody's good?
Ann Brown, Dodge has just got back on our truck contract, right? All right, so thank you, Mark, for that presentation. Next up is Mark Lutz to talk about pavement management. And like Shanté said, it got moved on under Mark, so he's going to just give you a quick update on that.
Thanks again, Maureen. So you'll have a survey for everybody at the end of all this, right? So one of the questions, if we don't have it this year, next year needs to be something online of, you know, who has the most smart aleck stuff in their presentations? Because, so I'm torn right now. So Buckalew gave it a shot. You know, he threw a couple in. I'm not in the running at all this year. I'm not getting there with this one. But so between the Star Wars theme from Taylor and Harbeson spent 90% of his effort being a smart aleck. I am torn as to which one I'm going to, and Shanté, did you notice that the DOTS building had the Empire symbol on it? So I just wanted to make sure that the M&O buildings were all the Alliance and DOTS was the Empire. I'm all right with that. All right, so I've been coming to, Mark has been coming for 19 years and others, I don't know how many years I've been coming to these because before I was at DelDOT, I was coming as a consultant. And so this is probably my first presentation ever that's not a traffic geek presentation. So talk a little bit about pavement management. So here's our pavement management group. It is not a big group for the size of a program we have. So we have Sarah McDougall is in charge of the group, and she has Mike, Paul, and Larry helping her out right now. Rhonda recently retired, so we have that position posted. We have several consultants that help out with this. Our road ratings, AECOM and Mandalay. Our pavement management software and the company that helped put this presentation together is Kircher. And then I started to list out the consultants that help with the design packages, and it got to be too many. So there's a lot of consultants that help put the design packages together. Also, we have major support from a lot of different parts of the department, and so I'm sure I'm going to offend somebody, but wanted to give some shout outs to the construction folks that implement these projects, Brian, Wayne, George, and Chris, some of which I saw here today, but maybe I don't know if they're all here today or not. And in traffic, a lot of folks in traffic work on these, but particularly Max and Natre spend a lot of effort on the signing, striping, signal plans for this large program. And again, there's a lot of other folks out there, but I just wanted to highlight some of the folks that are helping with this program. So briefly, the overall pavement management program is broken down into these five main parts. So the pavement condition and data collection, that's basically the road ratings. So we do the road ratings for all of the roads, all the state maintained roads every other year. And then on the off year, we're doing the NHS, the National Highway System. That's part of our requirements to FHWA. In addition, and I'll talk a little bit more about the data that's collected there, but in addition to the actual road ratings of the pavement, it's also collecting the video data that a lot of us use for a variety of purposes, and it's also collecting the LIDAR data that went into the inventory that our planning division put together a few years ago. And I also just wanted to put out there that every year, the road rating data collection is collecting the LIDAR data, but they're not necessarily processing it. So there may be things that we have raw data for that if you have money, we can work with the consultant to do some of the post-processing needed for that purpose. Then there's the pavement management system, pulling in the data and deciding, looking at our funding and deciding what roads we're going to be doing what treatments on, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. There's obviously monies involved, and then developing the individual estimates, and finally putting out the actual PS&E, and then building the projects. So here's a little bit of the history of the continuing evolution of our pavement management systems over the years. So dating back to 1990, when we started collecting data, and it was all manual at the time. So in 2007, we started doing a semi-automated, and that became the fully automated in 2016, where all the data was based on these systems that I'm going to tell you a little bit more about. Um, so So again, in the you know, before 2016, there was always a kind of a human element to it of, you know, people driving around the state, looking at the road and trying to, you know, assess based on some criteria of what the conditions are. And but starting in 2016, that's been all automated. In 2019 was a big year for the program. So first, the bottom note there that a lot of effort from a lot of groups, but between pavement management, bridge, and engineering support, put this document together called the TAMP, the Transportation Asset Management Plan. That's again a federal requirement, and it primarily focuses again on pavements and bridges, which across the country are by far the two most mature transportation asset management fields. So again, a lot of other things that DelDOT owns and maintains and we need to do asset management for, whether it's drainage or traffic signals or signs. But we have, again, nationally and in Delaware, we have some pretty mature programs for bridges and pavements. And then major system upgrades last year. We did a lot of work. The team did a lot of work on documenting standard procedures, development and finalization of a data dictionary that really well defines the pavement distresses, fleshing out of some of the decision trees that go into for the certain type of pavement and the certain distress that's found. What is the best treatment for those situations, and other upgrades like that. So here's just some views of some of the automated data collection. So it's obviously it's vehicle mounted equipment. We get imagery, we get camera view, we get LIDAR, we get this laser crack measurement system. It's finding basically the main thing that it's looking for is the location and the width and the depths of the cracks. For now, it's all looking at surface treatments or surface problems. Again, the width and the depth of cracks. We are looking at the possibility in the future of doing some ground penetrating radar to understand better what's underneath the surface. But as of now, it's all surface. So this slide kind of describes how the details get combined into a higher level. And at the end of the day, you get, for each segment of pavement, you get an overall pavement condition. So again, it's the actual, the fatigues, the potholes, the lateral cracking, the transverse, the longitudinal, and how that ties together into these different indices, which ultimately, again, end up in your OPC. So for the overall pavement condition, again, if those of you that kind of are paying attention to this a little bit, if that score is greater than 60, then the pavement's considered good. If it's 50 to 60, it's fair, and if it's less than 50, it's considered poor. And again, it goes back to depending on what the details are of the types of distresses and the types of pavement that you have, whether it's asphalt, composite, or concrete, then that the system helps us decide what kind of treatment to do on those roadways. I was going to talk a little bit about our actual overall ratings for Delaware, but I thought it was just going to get too confusing because there's two different rating systems. There's our Delaware rating system, and then there's the federal rating system, which don't line up exactly. So the federal system really focuses on the national highway system. So that's only a subset of our roads, of course. We need to worry about all of our state-maintained roads. So other than to say, when we did the TAMP last year, under both the Delaware rating system and the federal rating system, all of our targets were met. So all the different targets we met, that a certain percentage of roads are need to be good or better. And we only want a very small percentage of roads to be poor. So again, without getting into the details, both on the federal side and the state side, we met all those targets. And then really the trick moving ahead is to project out how is our pavement going to, how are those ratings going to move into the future, given our funding levels? And we want to try to predict, that. Are we going to be able to meet, are we going to be able to continue to meet those targets with funding levels? So this is just a little bit more about how we go through the system. We have our inventory. We get the condition data from the road ratings. We know what projects are out there. We look at the construction history. From that, again, we go through these decision trees. We look at the treatments. We combine that all together. These performance models are kind of what I was just talking about there, where if we have this performance model and we have this current rating and we have this amount of funding, projecting out into the future how our pavements are going to be performing in the future. Hopefully, some of you, if not all of you, have seen some kind of a graph like this in the past, talking about pavement management. Again, this is particularly for pavement management, but this kind of a curve is really applicable to a lot of things in asset management, where you have a slight drop in time over the pavement condition, and then there's a more rapid drop off kind of in the middle years. In this case, in the 10 to 20 year time frame is where you have a much more rapid drop off. And if you spend a little bit of money while you're still high up on that curve, you can improve the quality, and then it starts to deteriorate again. And then if you spend a little bit of money early, you get a lot more bang for your buck than spending a lot of money when the road really is totally falling apart. Here's an example of some of the treatments and kind of how we categorize them. So our friends in the Alliance are using the patching and the crack sealing and the day-to-day, and they're dealing with the complaints and they're doing the regular maintenance on those roadways. Then we have the kind of the preservation techniques. We don't do a lot of microsurfacing anymore, but still doing the ultra-thin overlays and chip seal type treatments. Then the rehabilitation side is the more what most people would think of as the pave and rehab, whether it's a pure overlay or the mill and fill type of job. And then we get into the full reconstruction. So a lot of you in this room, I'm sure, were involved in the 141 Center Road reconstruction. We did 113 down south a couple years ago. And so those are the more, at some point, you, no matter how much you do the preservation or the rehabilitation, at some point you're going to have to fully rebuild these roadways. So this is just kind of that same curve, but kind of more real actual data. Again, showing if you did nothing, it's the black line, and eventually the road turns to crap over a certain amount of time. But you want to do your preservations and then a rehabilitation, and you want to hopefully keep your road at a much higher rating for a much longer time. With that, just kind of wrapping up with the pavement management budget. I think Shanté mentioned it in her presentation that this is one of the biggest, if not the biggest, program that the department delivers every year. This year, or this fiscal year, 20 being the, just like for the department as a whole, this program is going to be spending over $130 million this year, a combination of state and federal money. We have, at least as of now, with where our budget looks to be in FY21, there's a big drop-off. And it stays low for the next couple years, and then so we'll see how that goes. Obviously, projecting out future funding is a challenge. We need to tie in big projects like the viaduct project, and how that's really going to take a hit out of our budget, as well as all the other capital projects that we're doing. And so the interesting thing to me is that, kind of coincidentally, both pavement management and on the bridge side, we're going to have updated performance models ready probably early this year on both of them, and we'll be able to kind of project out more accurately what the performance is going to be over the years given our budgets. So once we take a look at that, then I think we'll probably have some high-level discussions about, you know, are we putting the right amount of money into these programs, or does it need to be more, or does it need to be less? So that is it for me on that one. Any questions? All right, hopefully under 15 minutes on that one.
Mark just basically gave a TAMP presentation because all of that information is related to our TAMP. And what he was saying, not that this is a presentation, but real quick, it's real important because he talked about bridges and pavements, and that's what our asset classes are to do the TAMP. And what he hit on was exactly right. So Stephanie Johnson, if you're still here, that's what you're going to be doing for me on March 10th. just take his presentation. Okay, with that, our next presenters are John Cariano and Ting Guo, and they're going to talk about our SWIP track program, something that we're really excited to talk to you about as we go try something else for our ENS program.
Hi everyone, my name is Ting Guo. I'm the ENS engineer from the engineering support group. Today we're gonna talk about the SWIP track program, like Maureen said, we plan to implement.
Yeah, I'm John Cariano. I'm the group engineer for environmental stewardship. We've been looking at new ways to get better ENS compliance, and this is one of the softwares that we thought would help the department.
And Mary Hamilton, she's an ENS program manager. She also helped out with putting up together the slides and everything. I want to thank her. So why are we doing this? It's simple. It's required by law. As some of you may know, any land disturbance over 5,000 square feet requires an approved sediment and stormwater management plan. You guys know DelDOT has small to large scale roadway projects, small to large scale bridge projects. Maintenance has their maintenance building, pavement rehab, subdivisions. Most of them are over 5,000 square feet, thus needs an approved plan. But apparently DENREC has short of staff, they can't handle that many projects. So they had delegated agencies, including DelDOT and other municipality counties. We're delegated agency by DENREC, DENREC Sediment and Stormwater Program. We're kind of self-regulating because DelDOT, unlike other delegated agencies, DelDOT is the owner of most of the projects. So the delegation consists of plan review approving, which is done by the stormwater engineer, Vince. Also includes inspections during active construction phase, which is our program, and also includes post-construction BMP inspections, which is in Sarah's group, the MPDS engineer. These are the applicable laws and regulations, Delaware Title Code Title 7, Chapter 40, and the Delaware Sediment and Stormwater Regulations. That includes the Erosion and Sediment Control Handbook, the Post-Construction Stormwater BMP Standards and Specifications, and guidelines for operation and maintenance of these BMPs. Our DelDOT specifications, I believe, is Section 900, and also some of the standard details came from these handbooks and regulations. That's why we're doing this. As stated before, DENREC require, any project requires an approved plan. And one of the requirements for active construction phase, we need to conduct weekly and ring event inspections. Right now, everything is on paper. We use Excel sheets. We use different versions as time goes by. By the way, those versions change as frequent as our org chart. So it's just people complaining, you know. People who are for major projects, which is decided by our stormwater engineer, we assign projects to CCRs, certified construction reviewers. They're mostly consultants. They do work for us. They conduct the weekly ring event inspections on these paperworks. It's time consuming. They need to get on site, take pictures, put everything together, put it on the Excel sheets, convert it into PDF, let everyone sign it, and then send it to whoever's related, whether it's a construction or our program and other people. We're trying to figure out a way to simple, and all these, even though we're self-regulating, we're up to DENREC and EPA's audit. They can conduct a redelegation review, which consists of a field visit and record keeping audit. And also EPA will show up on your site without telling you and ask you information. So this is important that we keep everything in our record, and it's easy access for everyone, because we might not be on site. If EPA showed up suddenly, then the field personnel should have every information available for audit. We consulted several agencies, DENRECs using SWPPP simplified version for their regulatory visit, not as frequent as what our project does. And they told us Ohio DOT are having a customized SWPPP version. So we contact the software vendor. They customized a Delaware version for us. We did two small testing projects on these. We hope that these software can help us better communicate with DelDOT construction folks and the contractors. So the software itself, it's having two versions. Basically, there's one desktop dashboard. The other is a mobile device apps. People like me in the office, we access through the desktop dash version. We can get real-time inspection data, real-time notification, especially for those non-compliance or problem areas. Non-compliance is more related to designated BNP's best management practices. Problem areas is if you find trash or debris on site, there might not be necessary any BNP's, but that's a problem. Or you see sediment discharge into the stream. The CCRs will take pictures and let us know so we know right away so we can have corrective actions on it. I guess John will talk about the field mobile app version later. And both versions will have the current, like I said, the sediment stormwater plan, approved plan on both versions. So the field personnel will have the most update version, hopefully, when the EPA showed up on site, like, give me your most current version, and then we can provide that. Because sometimes, if it's on paper form, it might not, the construction folks on site might not have the most up-to-date version. So I'm going to show you the desktop dashboard. It's simple. It's web-based. As long as you have a username and password, you can log in. This is the main page you will see. It will tell you corrective actions, open items. The dashboard details how, like, it shows where and how long the open items have been passed due. This one also shows you different BNPs, Oh, by the way, those dashboard can be customized, like who's gonna have access, who can review it, who will get notification. So that's all can be customized by the vendor. And you can see from this page, every work item is documented and tracked and managed. Communication and follow-ups are automatic. And from this project, you can see there's a comprehensive history of every inspection, every BMP, and every work item. You will see key data points, inspection reports, work item, and precipitation history are provided. It's like a one-stop for project reports. If you click the left-hand side, there's a corrective action. You click that tab, it will show you this project's open items. Current conditions can be reviewed. An email can be sent to project parties if you see, okay, this item is overdue for so long, I really need to push somebody to do something. You can send that email automatically instead of trying to go back to your email. And this is one of the problem we have. You can open the work items. You'll see construction debris laying around. And on the next tab, you'll see remediation pictures. So if anyone from construction site or a contractor fix a problem, they can upload the picture and show, okay, we had the problem, but we fixed it. So it's better tracking. And same thing for all the other open items, BMP following. For one particular BMP, you can see the history of the whole process, like under November the 1st, inspection, what happened before. You can see the history and track it. Another issue we talked about is having the most up-to-date plan. We had challenges that EPA showed up on site. Most of the time, they will ask, one, if the project is over 1 acre, they will ask for NOI, which is Notice of Intention, that we file to DENREC. They will ask a copy for that. And the other one is they will ask for a most up-to-date plan. Sometimes a plan gets revised, changed, field personnel might not have the most up-to-date version. So as a program manager, we're responsible to upload the most current version so everyone else have the current version. And also, hopefully, SWPPP can also help Vince's program, like which designer is submitting plans, what's the status of review, acceptance. Hopefully, we can standardize within this program. This is what I said before. Such as take a road A project as an example. I think right now it's revision 16 or something. Can't correct me if I'm wrong. So this one has up to 11 on the dashboard. And it also has the NOI binder that we filed to DENREC, has record. So field personnel have access, can download it.
So I think the big thing is from Ting's side, the data management's a lot easier through this program. But I'm going to talk about the actual field inspection side. So we hire a third-party CCR to do our ENS compliance inspections. And what we're going to do with this app is we're going to upload all the temporary BMPs within the program. So it should already be populated with the information about what type of BMP, where the location is, the station, and the offset. And it just lists that in that left panel there. It even tells you a positioning, your positioning to the device that you're going to inspect. So there's an example up here that says you're 21.3 feet away from the concrete washout. And then it also gives you the option with the two images in the middle to have a compass direct you where the BMP is, as well as a map of all the active BMPs on that project. So basically what the inspector does, when they first get a job, all these are turned blue on the left because they're inactive. The initial inspection, the CCR would go through and activate those devices, and they would turn green. So what they would do is click the red inspect button, and it would go to the screen on the right over here. So that screen, it would put up a prompt for you. It would say, does this BMP meet the standards, or is corrective action needed? And then you would click one of those. So it's very intuitive. It prompts you with questions, and then you would go through and do your inspection. If corrective action is needed, then you would take a picture of that device and put some sort of note in there as to what needs to be remedied. There's also a voice dictation option that you could even push your microphone button and record your notes that way. Then if the device is no longer needed, say we have permanent stabilization, you don't need your device anymore, you can even hit the order BMP removal button there to notify the contractor that you don't need that BMP anymore. So the SWPPP program brings in weather data from local weather stations. The inspector, as part of the reporting, puts in the weather conditions at the time of observation. They have the ability to override that information. It's pre-populated when they open the app and perform the inspection. The app also sends out automatic emails when we have a greater than half inch rain event in a 24-hour period. So this will send an email to construction and the contractor that says, we've had this event, make sure all your devices are in order. So that's just another handy feature. It also has the option to measure installed quantities. So if the contractor has laid, 200 feet of silt fence that day, you can track it through the app. I think Ohio uses this for payment. I don't know if we're going to go that far, but the feature is available to us. And you could always add a new BMP when you're inspecting that might not have been on the approved plans, but if they took extra steps and put another device in, you could add that BMP for future inspections. Going back a couple slides, all those active BMPs, they have to be inspected before you can actually finish your inspection. That's one of the built-in safeguards, I think, of the SWPPP app. If the device is active, it requires you to inspect that device every time you're out there. On this slide, the general practices on the left, you can report on any one of those conditions that aren't necessarily associated with a specific BMP. So like if you want to report on permanent stabilization, if it's missing some seating, you would click the permanent stabilization button and it would open up with prompts and ask you, what's the deficiency, take a picture. Has there been a sediment discharge that you want to report on? Same thing, you would click that. It would ask you a series of questions and ask you to submit a picture along the way. And then prior to finishing the inspection, there's going to be a series of questions that the app will ask you just to ensure that you're doing a consistent inspection every time. And lastly, the CCR would sign off on the inspection before releasing it. Here's an example of what the inspection report looks like. It has the project information at the top, as well as the weather conditions. Of note is that red bar down at the bottom. That indicates that there is an open work item for more than 14 days, so it kind of highlights things that haven't been paid attention to over time, so it brings it to the top and puts a nice red color on it just to put it, right in your face. Also, there's a map for the location and the picture of the deficiencies. The software also allows for a virtual walk-along so you can see how the inspection was completed. It gives you a timestamp for the inspection of every device. So this allows Ting from the dashboard to see how the inspection was completed, making sure they're inspecting all active work areas. If there's a substitute CCR filling in that week, they can see what the last CCR did and follow a similar pattern in their inspection. Again, the report of note here at the bottom in green is we're not just tracking deficiencies, we're trying to track contractor efforts to improve compliance. So this shows you there was a deficiency and a few days later, I think a week later, they took action and solved the deficiency. So they took a progress photo and illustrated how it was resolved. I think the agencies want to see that just as much as the deficiencies to see how receptive you are to these site conditions. So again, the benefits, we're looking at consistent inspections. Having that GPS positioning is a big help, and making sure that you have to inspect all active BMPs. ensures that. Standardized reporting, it creates that standard format to go out to the contract parties. It allows you to manage the SWIP review process, track repairs and maintenance that the contractor takes to fix the problem, easy compliance tracking with the dashboard, and shows you the device history. You can even apply a filter to look at certain aspects of a job or certain devices to really tell the story. And then it generates the automated reportings and communications and follow-up emails. So we're not sitting behind a desk sending emails and saying, hey, this issue is still unresolved. Every so many days, it'll send a notification to the contractor and say, this is still an open work item. How are you going to fix this? Shanté had mentioned earlier about a pilot program that we're going to try to take on here at DelDOT. In talking with the Ohio DOT people, we learned about their program, and we're always, you know, interested in trying to get better ENS compliance. So basically, this program is going to be, we're going to give the awarded contractor the responsibility to develop the SWIP. If they have a PE on staff, they can develop it, or they can hire a consultant to do so. DelDOT will then review and approve the SWIP. The contractor will become the co-permittee on the job, and they're going to construct the project within the constraints of the SWIP. Then they'll hire a third-party CCR to perform these inspections utilizing the SWIPTrack app, and then we, as DelDOT, will provide quality inspections and utilize the dashboard to ensure compliance. So next steps. We are in the process of working with DTI to customize the SWIPTrack for DelDOT-specific workflow. We want to put things in there like the permanent BMP, the stormwater facility construction checklist, so we can provide that to Sarah's group. Also, we want to standardize our reporting. Then we will implement this on all projects with the CCR going forward. For that, we're going to have to create a pay item for each contract. So it'll be a bid item. It'll be likely fixed. Then we'll do training for DelDOT consultants and construction staff that will be doing the inspections. And then lastly, we want to make sure it coordinates with Unifier. We're putting everything in Unifier as it is. So we're going to have an export of the report and the information to our Unifier program for long-term data retention. And then for the pilot program, we have a draft of the special provision with DCA right now. I believe we're meeting this week with them to discuss it. We've also developed an ENS design guide to help SWIP designers along the way who don't normally develop a ENS plan for a linear transportation project, some things to consider. And then we're going to do 4 in-house projects on that program going forward. And that's it. Any questions? Yes, Rob.
John, so great. On the pilot program.
Yes.
Do you have to provide the any drawing in there for erosion sediment control, like we do for MOT? You have to show them something, but then they're allowed to alter it. Is that how you're going forward, or is this
So the question was, do we have to provide any sort of preliminary ENS drawing to the contractor during advertisement? Right now, my understanding is that we're not. We're going to leave the ENS off the plans. We will provide information to the awarded contractor for them to develop, you know, an ENS plan. So right now, we're not going to provide that. Yeah. Anybody else? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, John and Ting. Who knew that we had a good presenter in Ting and her little smart aleck comment about work charts and stuff. Our next presenter is Scott Nider and Jonathan Hermes talking about our rail program, and as you remember, it got reassigned, so I'm sure they're going to talk all about that.
Good morning, everyone. For those of you who don't know, I'm Scott Neidert. I'm the Highway Safety Improvement Program Manager for Traffic. I also manage the department's crash data program. And as of recent, I manage the department's railroad coordination program. All right, so our quick little presentation here. The agenda, I want to go over the program updates, the general overview of the program, and the program goals, so where we see this program going in the future. So some quotes and comments I got related to the projects and the programs upon being tasked with the program. So instead of hearing, you know, congratulations, you know, way to go, this is awesome, I got some pretty good comments. Rail to nowhere, basically saying, you know, everything is a no with the rail program. You know, when you have a project that involves rail, it's going to add an additional 2 years to the project. And the best one was to avoid it at all cost, or it'll derail the project. Hilarious. So with that being said, we're going to leave all that behind, and we're going to work toward the rail program of the future, making some pretty significant changes. So the program updates here. Shanté alluded to, we recently reorganized into DelDOT traffic in early fall of 2019. And we've recently hired a DelDOT Railroad coordinating engineer. That's Rich Siniger. You may remember Rich from back in 2015. He was in the TE program in planning. So he's back, and he has taken the spot of Bob Perrine. And his contact information is here. And of course, we have the consulting staff of Century Engineering and Rabinsky Engineering. They've been absolutely instrumental helping me with this program throughout the transition. And I want to give a shout out to Whitman Reckwart, who manages our highway rail grade crossing safety program.
Thank you, Scott. My name's John Hermes. I am working with Century Engineering. We do support the rail program. Usually when we tell people that they have to deal with the rail program, they start thinking of ways to, as I said, avoid it, give it to pavement rehab, give it to some other thing, anything they can do to avoid working with it. So with some of the changes that we're going to be making, we're hoping to alleviate that concern. I'm not going to say you're ever going to like working with the rail program, but it's going to be a lot better. So the biggest question that we get is, when do you have to contact someone from the rail section? It's kind of like a two-part question. The first is, if you have any dealings with a freight railroad. The second part of that is, there's passenger rail. That's Amtrak. DTC currently coordinates with Amtrak. We do not have that in our scope of work as of right now. There are some discussions with DTC and DelDOT to determine if they want to bring that into the railroad section, but as of right now, it's only the freight railroad. You can see on the screen there are 7 primary railroads that operate in Delaware. Only one is a passenger rail. All the others are freight railroads. They operate throughout the state. The Wilmington Western is an excursion rail. It's a historic railroad up in New Castle County. They don't carry freight, but they fall under freight for our purposes. There's approximately 371 at-grade crossings. That's where a highway and a railroad intersect. There's an additional 115 grade separated crossings. These are all the public crossings. There's many, many, many more farm crossings, industrial crossings. We don't deal with the private crossings. We only deal with the public and the freight railroad. So those are the two main criteria of when you need to contact the railroad section. What are we responsible for? In a capital project, when to contact us? As soon as there's the potential for having railroad involvement. We need to go ahead and get agreements set up. These are preliminary engineering agreements with the railroad. We continue the agreement process throughout the life of the contract, getting construction agreements, trespass agreements. Those are titles from the railroad side. We also are instrumental in setting up the estimates. You need to make sure that you have a budget for the railroad within your project and set it up early on. If you deal with the railroad, you can have flagging costs of $1,200 to $1,500 a day. So it really adds up quickly. So we need to make sure that these are accounted for early on. You might be a little bit more familiar with the railroad statements. The railroad section handles all railroad statements. Every project needs a railroad statement. I understand if you're doing a project in Dewey Beach, you're not going to have railroad impacts, but you still need a statement. Get a hold of us. We'll go ahead and fill it out most of the time. It's just a real quick no involvement statement, and we get it submitted. You can check that off the to-do list. We're also involved in obtaining master railroad agreements. The advantage of this is these agreements can take the place of some scope of work on your project. The railroad section can be responsible to pulling that work out so it can either be done in front of or during in conjunction with the capital project. But that way the roadway contractor doesn't have to deal with insurance, doesn't have to deal with the railroad. It streamlines the process. As Scott said, Whitman works on the HSIP project. They go out and they identify the deficiencies at all existing grade crossings and see if you can make it safer. Adding striping, signing, putting on flashing lights, adding gates, or some combination of that. With these two groups, these two programs being under traffic and under Scott, now we hope to have some efficiencies of scale and also be able to coordinate a little bit faster. The biggest thing that we do is the everyday contacts with everyone in this room. If there's a rideability issue, if there's potholes, if you get calls from maintenance that there's branches blocking the lights, if there's a malfunction, if you have a project where you're near a railroad, but you don't know where the right-of-way is, all these things, you call the railroad section and we'll provide an answer to you. One of the tools that we use, we're not very creative, so the name Railroad Program Management Application could do a little bit better. But this is basically a large database that has all the information of every single crossing in the state. So if you call us, we can click on a button, we can tell you who the owner and operator is, what safety features are there, show you current pictures, and tell you when other work has been done. So this is a great tool, and the purpose of it is to respond to you quickly. That's one of the things that we heard from a lot of our interviews, is that you weren't getting responses from the railroad section in the past. And that's something that we're gonna change. What is our section responsible for with terms of maintenance of the railroad crossings? We do maintenance projects, we do drainage, we do pavement rehabs, we coordinate with Sarah and Mike to make sure that we're not overlapping, and if it is, we go out, pave roughly 130 feet on either side of the crossing and try and get it before their project. But our maintenance is really a mill and overlay. It's to preserve the rideability of the crossing so you don't have to do a major repair. Sometimes the crossing is so deteriorated, you just have to rip it out. It seems like common sense, but what we've started doing in the last couple of years is making sure we get everyone involved. Traffic, ITMS, PAR routes, anything that needs to be done, including drainage, we address at one time. It may take a little bit longer, but we get it done once. That improves the overall project. No one has to come back in and deal with the railroad for a much longer period of time. We also have a program where we look to close individual crossings. If it's a low volume road or if it's a town like Georgetown, we have several crossings just a block apart, maybe we can potentially close those. So that's something we also investigate. We have a monitoring program that looks at every crossing every year, rates it, and we develop our improvement program based on that. And we also have the state-owned line. Some of you may not know, we own a railroad, DelDOT owns a railroad, the Milton line and the Georgetown to Lewis. So we're responsible for coordinating any maintenance on that whole rail line, whether it's clearing, grubbing, drainage, safety improvements at the crossing, and coordinating with other projects and municipalities or utilities that go through there. So those are our responsibilities. So that's a quick overview of the work that we're doing. I'd like to turn it back over to Scott, talk about some of the goals, where we're going moving forward.
Thanks, John. So some of the program goals moving forward, John had already mentioned this, but we're gonna focus on improving the processes of our section to achieve the enhanced expedited project support for all of you. And then, you know, some questions that we've been asking ourselves lately, was it clear what was actually expected of the section? Were the roles and responsibilities of the rail section clearly identified? So we wanna move forward and try to answer those questions for you to make these processes go better. So in the works right now, we have the Railroad Coordination Manual. We hope to publish this in the fall of 2020. Over the past couple years, we've been kind of interviewing different sections around the department to determine what your specific needs are from us. And we're compiling those needs, we're adding some of our own, and we're hoping to have this out to the Design Resource Center, the DRC, later this year. We also want to link the real-time railroad inventory application, the RPM, with our gateway application. That way, not only will we be able to see the activities and the equipment that's at every crossing, but you'll be able to see it as well. We think that'll help speed up some of these projects. And then we want to formalize an SOP for railroad incidents being reported to the TMC. We don't always get notified right away, but TMC sure does. So we want to make sure that the TMC is calling us, and then that way we can respond as needed. Again, we're going to continually look for ways to streamline railroad processes to benefit everyone. If you have any suggestions, questions, comments, feel free. You guys know where I work. Improve responsiveness and efficiency for all rail projects statewide. And we also want to attain additional training and expertise with FRA requirements and apply them to DelDOT projects moving forward. So we'll be working with ASHTO, FHWA as well, to help us become better acclimated to FRA's expectations. Any questions? Thank you very much.
All right, great. Thanks, Scott and John. Okay, our last presentation is the I-95 rehabilitation, and Craig Stevens is standing between you and lunch. All right.
Hi, how's everyone doing? Good, okay. I'm a little disappointed. Here's the two things I heard on the way up here, by the way. You have 10 minutes. And the other thing was, Craig, go on up there. Don't be inappropriate, but be funny. I don't think it's possible for me to be funny without being inappropriate, so one of those has got to go. But today I sit here because of delegation. How many managers here, raise your hand if you heard of delegation before? Now, who's ever gotten anything delegated to them? Raise your hand. Be proud. Now, when you get something delegated, Eric Simo, right? When someone gets delegated to you, you have two options. You can do a real crappy job at it and never get delegated again, or you can try and do well, right? So here goes my crappy job at this presentation. See, this is what Jason gets for putting me up here instead of him. So hopefully I know how to work this. Basically, who's heard that we're going to work on I-95? You probably heard we're going to shut down the entire city. True? Mark, is that true? Are we shutting down the whole city?
False. Fake news.
The goal of this project is not to shut down. It's actually to maintain and preserve the I-95 corridor, ensure 30 years of maintenance-free. I'm looking at Mark Buckalew right now. Maintenance-free, even though we went with asphalt, right? How'd that feel? Good? No? All right. So maintenance-free, we decided to go with asphalt, so it's not totally 30 years maintenance-free, but that's our goal. And we want to enhance safety, improve roadway efficiency to lessen traffic congestion. I'm actually reading the slide. I've never done this before. Implement improvements to the city of Wilmington. Okay, that's boring. Let's move on. Basically, the project overview, I could have put a nice picture up here, but you guys, what are we having for lunch, by the way?
We're having pork chops. The other white meat, right?
One per person. One per person. Jeez Louise. All right. So anyway, rehabilitation of 19 bridges, 3 miles of pavement. And the doors, you have 2 safety exits right here and here. Oxygen comes down if you need it. Always give it to yourself before your child. The oxygen is important. Okay, and we want to improve the Second Street. It's a lot of accidents at Second Street. So this is a very busy slide. If you don't like it, Whitman put it together. His name's Bill Getschrei. I don't want to call him, bless his heart, you know what I mean? Or I could say, out of all due respect, this is a confusing slide, right? So basically all you care about or the public cares about in this, well, first thing I wanted to point out is what I like about this project. It's almost like we're as slow as PD, because we started in 2014 and we're in 2021, we're gonna get done. So it's really cool to feel what it's like to spend a whole career on one project. Ooh, was that appropriate? I'm just kidding. We only have 4 parcels though. That's it, 4 parcels, that's it. You guys are idiots. Okay, moving on. March 2021 is when we shut down our we shut down lanes. We do some different traffic configurations. Did everybody get this slide? Did we all read it? Is it good? Okay. Moving on. Right now we have some breakout contracts you probably have not heard of, or maybe you have. But we have the cantilever signs and overhead structures. Who knows what a cantilever is? This is some fun stuff. Man, don't raise your hand, because I'll call on these two young ladies here. I'm about ready to call on her, ask her what it is, and she won't be able to tell me, so I won't do it. Anyway, cantilever, overhead signs. It was awarded to Fletcher, Creamer, and Son Incorporated. I hope I said that right. Then we have the I-95. This has been advertised, and actually, this has also been, the bid tab has been analyzed. That's all I'll say. Is that legally right? Okay, and then I-95 bearing placements has been advertised. So moving on, what does CMGC stand for? Barry, don't look away from me. Do you know? What does it stand for, Barry? Construction Manager General Contractor. Who agrees with him? Raise your hand. He's wrong. Just kidding. I'm just joking. It is construction. All right. This is fun, isn't it? We're going to keep going. How much time do I have, Jay? 5 minutes. So 10 minutes is going to work. All right. How does CMGC work, Barry? Smart Alec. Look how Barry's sitting, by the way. When he worked here, he never sat like that. He was sitting up. He's all chilling back. He's got that big GPI paycheck coming. Look at him. Look at him sitting next to Rob. They're all like, I've never seen them so relaxed in my life. After this, he's going to hop into his spa. Am I wrong? You're going to probably hit your spa tonight. All right. But go. You don't have to tell me how it works, Barry. What a shock. I can tell you. No, you're not going to be able to tell me. Okay. It's a has anyone ever heard of CMGC? So it's basically, you know how we do low bid and we get excellent quality when we do low bid build and things get done on time? You know how that works? Why are we laughing? I'm dead serious. So basically CMGC is a different way to do it. You get a qualification-based people, that wasn't very good, contractors. You get them in, we get to select construction manager, general contractor, and it allows us to get their ideas on how they're going to build this so that we can actually cater our schedule and what we do to that. Because how many people have guessed on how long something will take in the project development stage? Raise your hand. How many people have guessed that? How many people have ever been wrong? Mark, I appreciate your honesty there, Mark. That's why you're a good leader, because you admit fault. That's good. So it appropriately manages risk in procurement. Was just recently done. So we have somebody on board. And guess who? Oh, I wanted to bring this up. Traffic operations the second Mark left, I think traffic operations stepped up and took over. Is that true, Mark? Mark's pissed at me right now. Did I lose you? Love you. He likes the Redskins too. That's what's important. But traffic, you know what's funny? One reason I'm going so fast is I really do have to pee. So I looked at Jason, I was like, gosh, I hope this goes. So I got to hustle too. But they helped out a lot. And how'd they do it? This is not a sign of where the coronavirus is right now. It's not what this is. Was that inappropriate? Was that coronavirus? It's too soon. I tell you what, I'd like to be stuck on a cruise ship for 2.5 weeks, eating lobster and watching what you're not supposed to all day. All right, so moving on. This is the lights are going to take over, okay? Over 200 traffic signals, adjust signal timing and response. And this is something that, where is he, by the way? Where's Don? Jason, I'm looking at you. Where's Don? Oh, you would know because you just got back from Paris. Priorities for upcoming contract work and basically going to set up some Bluetooth devices. This is all geeky stuff, you know what I'm saying? So they're really working with this. They're not the only section, but I thought that they were really excited about getting 100 new signals. So I thought I'd tell them good job. So why am I doing this presentation? Now, there's really two reasons. I'm going to call our friends. They start with a and then an itman, too, on this. Now, basically,
Jason told me he may be too sleepy to do this because he was in Paris. Oui, très bien, si.
Well, I just threw Spanish in there, see? I suck. All right, so anyway, he said he was too tired, so I asked Whitman to do it, and they said, well, the person said, I've got to walk my dogs. So those are the two excuses, and that's why you get this project or this presentation you're not really learning much about. So here's Kevin and Jason working in Miami. Now, I don't know what Jason's doing right now, but it looks like he's about ready to ride a pony, don't he? Like, well, I have no idea what's going on. Kevin, I don't know what Kevin's wearing. His shirt's a little tight, I think. But he likes his short. Soon after this, Kevin almost got hit by a vehicle. Right? Remember? Just almost, he ran into a vehicle, and Jason told me, God, I wish something would happen because I like his shorts. He was going to take his shorts. So this is the way he was working in Paris, maybe? Inappropriate? Could have been worse. So anyway, we chose to go with Kiewit. Sorry, I get sidetracked, a little ADD there. But the CMGC, here's what we got. Now, I want construction. I count 22 workers on this job. Does anyone know where this is? Huh? 3-150. Do we know where that is? Rehoboth, very good. I counted 22 workers. This is Kiewit. How much time I got, Jay? You're looking at me with those, with your bedroom eyes. Just kidding. He's always looking deep. He sees right through me. It's crazy. Kiewit, and that's the same company, obviously, that we did with the I-95, but they're doing a great job. I think they're tracking 3 weeks ahead of time. And I don't believe we have claims or anything, so that's really good news. We're doing some public outreach. Why not, right? We have a public website. Make sure that's updated. Mark Lutz told me to tell you that. Presentations, too. Two meetings, stakeholder groups. We have a CAG group, Community Advisory Group. We have briefings with Governor Carney and Senator Carper. They don't let me go to those. I've never been to them. In fact, they had a meeting with Secretary Cohan the other day. I was not invited. I go, Jay, what's going on? And he's like, no. And notice she left right before I started. I guess she wants pliable deniability. Is that the right thing? Plausible? Plausible deniability, not pliable. Update meeting city with state officials. Okay, moving on. We're going to have an incident management plan, active traffic management system, revised signal timings, which I told you about. We are going to pave some streets for Wilmington. A lot of fun to work with Wilmington. Enhance public transportation services. So, this is delegation. For more information, reach out to Jason and reach out to... Now, Marine's getting up, but I ain't done. I know where you're going, girl, but I ain't done. All right, so Percy McNeil, that's the guy you want to get in touch with, not Craig or Jason Hastings. So we right now what we're going to do is we're going to reinspect the bridges. We got some early work packages that should start in 2020, and mainline construction will be in 2021. Breakout contracts will start in 2019. Yeah, winter. Yeah, that's true, right? We're going to, not really, but yeah, kind of. 2020, pavement rehabilitation projects are ongoing. There. Now I'm done. Any questions? Oh, you son of a gun. What do you need? Oh, it's...
I got two. Don Weber wanted me to tell you he's at TMC trying to figure out how to take over 200
feet. 200? Did I say the wrong number? All right, Donnie says that he wants... I don't know what the heck he said, but he's being a little baby. I'm just kidding. He's not being a baby. I love Don. I love him to death. God bless him. What was the second one? Do I like my job? Yes, I do. I love my job.
She's kicking me off.
I'm preserving your job. All right, so as I had Craig say, we are having pork chops. We do have some extra people that are here that did not sign up originally, so we had already had our catering number. So please, one pork chop for the first round, and if there's still some left, you're free to, you know, eat away. But we are going to do 45 minutes, so what's the time right now? 11:36. Oh, goodness, what's that?
I didn't have to be an engineer for a long time. I'm a manager. just be back, and we'll say 25 after. Is that about, that gives us 4 extra minutes. So 25 after 12, please. Oh, doors. Not around. Doors. All right, go.